A very good morning to everybody present here. It's very happy to be here today with all of you. Lot of familiar faces we are seeing over the last 2 years, every SPOC workshop, a lot of new people we are meeting who have become local chapters in the last few months or have started activating the local chapters in the last few months. So welcome to all of you. And Madras weather has been generous to us in the last 2-3 days. We've been having some showers, so it's actually cooler as compared to the, you know, hot days we have been having maybe 2 weeks or 3 weeks back. So welcome to all the SPOCs. We also have our chief guest of the day today, Professor Duraiswamy, who is the Vice Chancellor of Madras University. And we have Professor Anant with us, who again started the entire NPTEL initiative from 99. So we are very happy to have you here with us today, sir. Thank you for gracing this occasion. I mean, it would never tire us, or I think we can never say enough to say, you know, how he started it and where the program is today is all because of his efforts and Professor Mangal Sundar's efforts. Mangal Sundar is in Canada. He's not here with us today, but he sent us his wishes for the event to be a success. So it's because of them that the whole NPTEL started, and for about 10 years they were going on with it, creating the repository. And only upon that we have built the certification effort today. We are also happy to have with us Dr. Nalamuthu Kodandaraman, Director of UGC Human Resources Development Center and Head, also with us today. Thank you, sir, for coming over. And we have some industry associates. We'll tell you about the new program we've started. So we have some people from the industry also partnering with us. So welcome to them. We have, we'll shortly have with us the senior consultant from the MHRD, Shri Parameshwaran. He will be joining us shortly. We have the team from Persistent. We will introduce shortly again. So welcome to the team. They're going to take over the Swayam portal and also our online courses portal. Shortly, they'll be integrating both. So that is on. We have representatives from the Google team who have been supporting us over the last 4 years. So welcome again. We'll have more people joining us from our other partners too. So we'll introduce them as we go. We'll start off with the welcome address. I request Professor Andrew to come in and start off. Then we'll have. So the program of the day goes like this. I'll just give you a brief. So we have a welcome address. Then we have an update on what we have done over the last 6 months and where we are today. Then an address by the chief guest. And the top 10 local chapters we will facilitate. 11 o'clock we'll have a tea break. After that, we'll have an update on local chapters, processes, new initiatives, followed by discussion and interaction, and then we'll have the felicitation of the other LCs who are here today. Lunch should be at 2 o'clock, and we'll close the program with that.
Very good morning to all of you. A very, very warm welcome to IIT Madras on my behalf and behalf of the entire NPTEL family. I think all of you are part of the NPTEL family now. It's been 4 years that we've been in this journey together, and it's wonderful to see the enthusiasm, everybody being here. I would like to especially welcome Professor Duraiswamy, is Vice Chancellor of Madras University, who's decided to kindly agree to grace this occasion and be the chief guest. We will hear more from him when he addresses us. Professor Anant, always is happy to see him. Professor Nagarajan, who's Dean of International Affairs at IIT Madras, he's been a huge support as well. So let me get started. Mostly this event is a little informal. It's not a very formal event where we do things. So hopefully you're okay with the informal agenda. So I'll get started with important updates. My so-called welcome address is supposed to be a quick rush through of the numbers that happened in the last semester. Where are we, what we have accomplished, how many students have benefited, etc. Those kind of numbers I'll present real quick, and then we'll move on to the other things. Okay, so here's what I'll talk about. Statistics are quite important whenever you run a program. If you ignore that, you're doing random things. So we will look at the numbers and show you what is it that we've accomplished in the last semester in comparison to what has happened before and in anticipation of what will happen in the next semester. Okay, so we need your continuous input to make sense of all these statistics also. We'll do that in the later interaction sessions. So today, I think what Professor Anant and Professor Mangal started 20 years ago is on really solid ground. Okay, so it is, if not the largest, one of the largest repositories of educational content in the world. There is no doubt about it. The numbers are really tremendous. Hundreds of millions of hits on the YouTube channel. We have more than 13 lakh subscribers to our YouTube channel. Remember, this is an educational channel. It's not an entertainment channel from some pop singer or something like that. These are educational channel with professors giving lectures. Okay, so to have 13 lakh subscribers who are subscribing, this is amazing. And one of the things you'll see in any conference I go to, even in last month I was at a conference in the US, two, three people walk up to me and said, you know, this lecture that you have given in NPTEL, I use it in my course every day. This is like in the leading international conferences. So this is used world over by people all across, and they really appreciate it. Definitely, the Indian audience is our primary target, and people in India also appreciate it quite a bit. And these numbers, I don't have to read them out to you. They are really very big. And in India, there are very few multi-institutional projects which can claim any kind of success like this, having delivered numbers at this rate. And again, the credit goes to Professor Anant and Professor Mangal's vision and their inclusiveness in including so many people in their program, creating a larger NPTEL family and community, which has driven this growth to these kind of levels. And we hope to carry forward that agenda. Okay, so since 2014, we have started the certification effort. I think for many of the older people who have been with us for a long time, this is all information that's known. Please bear with me. There are a few people who are new, and it's good to talk to everybody about these basic numbers. We started the certification effort in 2014. It was inaugurated at the MHRD by the then government, and in fact, we have a representative from the ministry also here, Sri Parameshwaran, who's a senior consultant at MHRD, and he manages the Swayam project, and he's the one who gives us all the money. So without him, nothing will happen. Okay. So what is it that we do in this online certification program? Every semester we offer courses. At the end of the courses, we conduct exams, and those who pass exams get certificates. Okay, these exams are held in centers all across the country. Many of your students have written these exams. So to date, we have finished to 740 courses. And with this semester, we will cross the magical 1,000 number mark. We are doing 270 courses this semester. So we will get to the 1,000 mark this semester, 1,010, I guess. It's comfortably above 1,000. Okay. More than 36 lakh students have, I'm saying students, but when I say students, I really mean learners. These could be anybody. 36 lakh people have enrolled and benefited, and more than 2.7 lakh have actually written the exam. So this is a major phenomenal growth for this program. It started in a small way. Hopefully, I'll show you more details. I like to put up this slide because once in a while, we should have the Western way of driving us, which is having a vision, mission, and then purpose, etc., policies and procedures. So the vision of NPTEL has always been to provide high quality, affordable education at large scale. Okay, so there are a lot of conflicting things in that sentence, but that's what we strive for. And how do we do that? We develop content, we offer online courses, we promote use and adoption by colleges and universities. And we've been successful in this effort largely because of the cooperation of local chapters. There's no doubt about that. You'll see more going forward. Just to make sure we are on the same page, the MOOCs contain video lectures, assignments, there is a forum where you can ask questions, there are text transcripts for the lectures, and there's also live interactive sessions once in a while that are held by faculty. All of this happens in our MOOCs. Okay, so what is the kind of learner engagement is expected per week? Okay, so typically there are about 3 to 4 hours of video lectures in a week. There is an assignment which people are saying 2 hours, but believe me, for a programming course you'll have to write 4 programs, and that will take about 6-7 hours if you're not used to programming. Of course, you have to get it to work, not just write, so that takes some time. There is a discussion forum if you are really keen and active. For instance, there's a course called Deep Learning, which is a very popular topic today. And the course released lectures yesterday. I think yesterday or day before lectures were released. And yesterday I was looking at the forum. There are already nearly 100 topics on the forum. People are asking so many questions. So if you're active on the forum, you want to look at all the questions, that will take much more than 1 hour a week. Okay. And also there's text transcripts and everything that you can do. So about every week, you can expect about 10 hours of interaction with the material, and that gives you what you learn from them. Okay, so how is it that we have grown? I said we started very small. In 2014, we had just one course. Okay, and in this current semester, we are running 270 courses. Okay, the growth has been really big, and the growth has been big largely in participation in numbers has come from local chapters, and your role in motivating your students is absolutely vital here. Otherwise, it's very difficult for us to reach out to students directly, right? So I think your role is very important. Equally important has been the enthusiasm of faculty at IITs to offer these courses, right? As you can imagine, without faculty coming forward eagerly and offering courses, nothing will happen. And they've also been motivated seeing these numbers, and that is something that's very nice to see. Okay, and so I want to say a few words about impact also. So you will see a lot of people enrolling for these courses. Lakhs of people, tens of lakhs of people will enroll for these courses. About 8 or 9% of them will write the exam. Okay, that is to be expected because this is an open process. I'll also give you some other numbers in the next slide to give you more nuanced data on this. Okay. So now enrolling in a course is very easy. You just go click the join button. You don't have to do anything, right? But really to participate, you have to do much more. And to measure that, we have done a little bit closer study of the statistic, and that is also very promising. Okay. So there are three numbers for every semester in this chart. Okay. For instance, if you take January to April 2018, there are three numbers. First number I'll talk about is 45, which is the, okay, so no, maybe first number I should talk about is 9, which is the smallest number, okay. This is the fraction of people who wrote the exam from divided by, I mean, number of people who wrote the exam divided by the number of people who enrolled in the course, okay. So that is coming out something like 9%, okay. So you'd say it's very less, okay. But I think that is a wrong way of looking at the data, okay. First thing you should look at is how many people submitted the first assignment. Okay, that is the next number, which is 21. Okay, 21% of the people submitted the first assignment. Okay, so there is this big pool of people who enrolled for the course. Just click the join button. They are really not interested. The people who are genuinely interested, I would say, are the people who submitted the first assignment. That is only about 21%. Now, out of that 21%, how many people wrote the exam? Okay, that is close to 45% in the January to April 2018 semester. Okay, so in NPTEL, we watch these numbers very closely. All these three numbers we watch very closely. And this is a measure of success of a course in some sense. For instance, that 45 number for the good courses will be much, much higher. It will be close to 60, 70, that kind of numbers you'll see. Okay, for the not so good courses, it will be lower. And we have our feedback and calibration and correction based on that. Okay. But still, that 45 is a pretty good number, I think. It's not a bad number. It means the teacher is doing a good job, right? So once the student gets hooked in, something is happening with the student, okay? So I'm going to stop at this slide. For the remaining of the slides in the initial update part, Professor Pratap will come up and present them. After that, we'll continue with the program. So Professor Pratap Haridas is in the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering. He's one of the coordinators of NPTEL at IIT Madras.
Good morning. I join Andrew, Niket, Bharati and others from the IIT Madras NPTEL team in welcoming all of you, the larger NPTEL family, to this LOC felicitation function today. So as Andrew was saying, we have come quite some distance since we started our initial activity in the online courses initiative. So you can see the number of courses that we have offered is what shows up here. You can see that, you know, since we started off with just one course, this immediate preceding run, we had about 226 courses, and in the upcoming run, we have 269 courses. So that's about 740 courses that we have completed, 16 exam runs. So that's actually been a very huge learning experience. We interact with a lot of people who try similar activities, both nationally and internationally. These numbers are not matched anywhere. Nobody has done 16 exam runs in the manner that we have done, which you know is relevant to the Indian scenario of how we want to do certification. We have 269 courses for the July-December 2018 semester, and already the enrollment is crossed 6 lakhs. So we expect that these numbers will keep increasing. This is something that shows the, again, another aspect of the NPTEL activity, which is quite unique, is the fact that we have courses across all disciplines. So we have courses across all the engineering disciplines. We do not just do courses based on overall popularity, just because the market happens to be driving things in a certain way today. We understand education is a broader concept, and I know there are people in various disciplines who have necessities, who are very valuable to society and so on. So all courses are covered here, all engineering streams are covered here. You can see significant number of institutes are also participating in this process. We really go and invite the best faculty from various well-established institutes, national institutes, get them to offer courses, which are then, you know, very useful to the general public. If you look at the type of courses that we have offered, You can see that in the recent past, if you look at the distribution of courses between rerun, repurposed, and new, you will see that for a long time, actually, the number of new courses was large. So we had 483 new courses from amongst the 740 that have been completed. So those are all new courses, meaning freshly it was designed. A faculty picked it up, taught it, and delivered it for the first time. 49 courses were repurposed courses. Repurposed is something that came from an existing NPTEL course, which was then converted to the MOOCs format. And then 208 are the courses that were rerun. So from the 483 and 49, they were rerun. So multiple offerings of those courses were there. You can see in the upcoming run, which is 269 courses, we are having a split, let's say, of 40-60% between new and rerun. So 60% is new and 40% is rerun. We think going forward, you will have more and more reruns. And in a way, we think that's a good thing because then the course is established. The faculty who is offering the course has a greater comfort level in how the course has been designed. They understand how it is being delivered on an online format. Because, I mean, even though it is new for the audience, it is also new for the faculty. They have, most of us have not offered a course in an online mode with an audience as diverse as we are seeing today on those courses and in a scale that the online course offers. So for most of the faculty offering these courses also, it's a very new experience. So as they get into reruns, that experience is, you know, built on, and they're able to deliver it in a much more effective way, both from their own satisfaction perspective and from the perspective of students. Also, it really helps us because then we can offer courses in a predictable manner. We can tell you, you know, that these many courses will appear in this semester and then other set of courses will appear in the other semester. So in those ways, this is a very good development, so to speak. Duration of courses. We have again had a split of courses in the amongst the completed courses. 8-week courses seem to be the larger number. 350 courses were, almost half the courses were 8-week courses. But we find increasingly going forward, so for example, in the upcoming run, we have a very large fraction that is the 12-week course. So a 12-week course is like a full semester course. The typical, you know, complete course that many of us offer in our institutions is what a 12-week course is. Usually an 8-week and a 4-week course is some kind of a specialized course. So where it doesn't appear to make sense to do a full 40-hour process. So I think for various reasons this may be true. I think partly this is also because credit transfer is now coming up in a big way. Often the students would like to take a complete course so that it reflects appropriately in their grade card. So if you look at exam attendance percentage, this is quite high. This is again percentage based on the number of people who registered for the examination. We think this is good because, I mean, the fees is not very high, so, I mean, people may register and not show up, but still this is a very good relative to any other exam process that we can compare against. And pass percentage is about 90% of those who register for the exams. Again, the way to look at it is the fact that the people who are registering for the exam have already done enough assignments and actually have some level of confidence that they can complete the course, and only then they are registering for the examination. So they are not students who are in a semester program somewhere who are forced to take a particular course because it is part of the curriculum, etc. These are courses that they're taking out of their own interest, and then they have completed a lot of assignments, so they have gained the confidence. So they consciously make the decision to take the exam or not to take the exam, and therefore naturally the pass percentage is high. We keep on doing a lot of surveys from amongst our students or the community that we are reaching out to understand why they're taking these courses, because it is very, first of all, very useful and informative to collect this information. It also helps us tune our efforts better, maybe expand on some efforts and so on. So you can see right now 2% is of the students are taking it for credit transfer. We expect that this 2% is going to keep growing because that's, I think, certainly an activity that a lot of people are taking up with a lot of interest. 30% are exploring new domains, 35% have taken it because college faculty encouraged them to take. So both of these are very good. In some fundamental sense, the MOOCs process that NPTEL is putting forward is primarily to give people the freedom to select what they wish to learn and not be constrained by what rank they got, what college they got, what department they ended up in, etc. And therefore, this exploring new domains is really capturing that audience. I mean, that fact that, you know, you can be in electrical engineering, you can do a management course, You can be in ocean engineering, you can do a computer science course, whatever it is that you wish to do, some economics course, whatever it is that you feel is required for a more complete education can be done here. We have a lot of other activities too. We have about 8% of the students taking it for GATE preparation, and 9% are taking it because it helps them with an existing job. So that's again a very important thing to take note of. It basically further conveys the fact that a lot of people, including working professionals, find these courses extremely useful to them. This is just gender statistics, gender-based statistics on how many are taking our courses. So you can see roughly it's a 60-40 split, which is pretty good considering, I mean, ideally it should be 50-50, but it's still better than what we tend to see in engineering education. Faculty participation is something that has significantly been increasing. So we have now, if you look at our more recent numbers, we are seeing close to 20% of people who are taking our courses being faculty in various institutions. So in the Jan-April run, we had more than 16,000 faculty from various colleges take our courses. We will show you something more about faculty development programs. We find that this is a nice, it leads in very nicely to faculty development programs and institutions, I mean, or bodies like AICT are very supportive of this activity. So so this is the distribution of highest marks. This is to give you an idea of how students are performing in our courses, to give you a sense of how easy or difficult the students find our courses to be. So if you see, there are 385 courses where the highest mark obtained in that course was somewhere between 91 and 100. So that's the last column that you see there. So 308 out of the 740 courses. So in roughly half the courses, you have the highest mark somewhere between 91 and 100. And then it tapers off. So then between 81 and 90, there are 205 courses, and then 71 and 80, 102, and so on. We have a very small number of courses. If you can see here, about 10 courses where the total mark, the highest mark obtained in the course was anywhere between 0 and 50 marks. So there was one course which had only between 0 and 10 marks as the highest mark obtained in that course. So the reason we show this information is that it also shows our learning process as we have gone forward in this activity. So initially, I mean, at the end of the day, all the faculty who offer these courses have complete freedom in selecting what level of evaluation, what kind of evaluation they wish to do for the student community. But at the same time, we give them enough feedback so that they understand how to tune their question papers, so that they are not only testing the student, they are also giving the student some feedback on what they have learned, what they have not learned. They're also, giving themselves some room to distinguish between students who really excelled in the course against students who have got some competence level in the course. So to do that, we gave them a lot of feedback on how to design their question papers, how to use their assignments, which are, you know, spread across the entire semester, to generate part of the question paper which has some semblance of that assignment activity, so that students who have actually stayed through the course and answered all assignments have a reasonable chance of clearing the course, because they've really learned something. I mean, they've learned something, so there's no point setting a paper where the idea is to eliminate, it's not like an entrance exam kind of a exam. It's more to figure out what the student has learned. So that is how, from, you know, having about 10 courses, which were some of our earlier courses, where the highest mark obtained in the course was 50 or less, we now have a situation where, about 80-90% of our courses, the highest marks are above that, which is more like what you would expect in a course. Okay, so then you also have the number of toppers that are there in any given course. So if you see here, if you see the right extreme, there are few courses, say for example, 3 courses, where we have had more than 200 people topping the course. Okay, so that means toppers would be, let's say, top 1%, 2% kind of thing, is what we refer to as a topper here. And that's only 3 courses, and the reason we have such a large number is because they are actually courses which are very mass appeal type courses. So there are courses which have several thousands of students, several tens of thousands of students enrolling for those courses. So in relation to the enrollment number, which is very large, that 200 is not a large number. So that's the way we would look at this graph. So if you come down, whereas vast majority of our courses, 481 courses, are courses where there are between 0 and 10 toppers. So that's, I think between this extreme and that extreme, that gives you an idea of how this information is laid out. So there are 137 courses where there are between 11 and 20 toppers. So this sort of also gives you an idea of this, you know, the number of students taking these courses, because that's how these topper numbers also change. And you can see those are the courses that are listed up there, Introduction to Programming in C, Soft Skills, Introduction to Internet of Things. These are the kinds of courses which have mass appeal. Large number of students take these courses, and then there correspondingly you have, you know, a large number of toppers as well. We've shared a lot of data here. We would like to take a few moments to acknowledge a lot of people who have been extremely supportive of this effort. This is a complex effort, and it involves a large community of people from diverse backgrounds who participate in it. First of all, we would like to thank MHRD for the funding of this program. They have been supportive of this program for now, almost 15 years that we have had this program in various forms, from the original NPTEL program to this current online certification program. Ever since it was started, Professor Anand and Professor Mangal Sundar had put in a lot of effort to get it started. From that time onwards, we have had considerable support for this program. Of course, the results have been encouraging, and so they have been very supportive, but through and through there has been so much support. Secretary for Higher Education, Sri Subramaniam, Dr. Sarvana Kumar, Ms. Malati, they are all from MHRD. Sri Parmeswaran, who has been kind enough to join us here today, they have all really been supportive in so many things that we have discussed with them in these times. So we would like to give them a big hand for this. Because it's a complex program, and on the ground we see a lot of detail, we see a lot of aspects that we would like to address in various ways, and it is very important for us to have people in these positions supporting us. Only then it's possible to deploy this in some kind of an organized way in the scale that we're talking about. We would also like to thank Google and YouTube, where they have allowed us to put all our courses without any ads being put up there. Large number of courses. You can see we have about 40,000 hours of video that has been put up. We have all these people to thank from Google, some of whom are here. Ashwini, Abhinav, Tej, Rishav is here, and Divi and Sagar. Arisen Technologies is again been extremely supportive of us and has actually made a big difference to the student community out there. We charge, basically because of the expenses associated with actually running the final examination, we are charging 1,100 rupees, which does not come across as a large sum of money in today's thinking of the costs involved. But still, in Tier 2, Tier 3 cities, it is a large sum of money, and people who have already paid a lot of fees for their college are finding it difficult. So this was again feedback that we received from the colleges. And we have had Arisen Technologies, Dr. Nuzat and Mr. Mudassir, who have been very supportive using CSR funding and enabling 50%, actually about 500 rupees fee reduction for students. And you can see 73,000 students have received this. So that's a huge accomplishment, so to speak. Again, I would like to thank them, and I also give them a hand for doing this for us. We would like to thank Tata Technologies, who are also now increasingly supporting us in the same kind of initiative with respect to fee waivers. We have other partners. We have TCS ION. I don't know if they are here already. Ram is here from TCS ION. So they have been extremely supportive of us with respect to the exam delivery process. So all the exams that students have taken in these past 4 years or so, almost all the exams are all with the assistance of TCS ION. They also do various exams here, including GATE exam. We work with them a lot because our requirements are very peculiar. Every course has some unique requirements, and it requires a partner of their nature who will work with us to try and satisfy those requirements. Of course, it also means that we are pushing boundaries, which means sometimes things go off smoothly, sometimes things don't go off smoothly, but that's the idea of the partnership. We have MathWorks, which has given us online access to MATLAB, and that has been very effectively used for a variety of courses. So students get access to a software package, which is very relevant to that course, and it also gives them training in that area, which they can then use in their workplace. We thank ICMR for co-certification of the course by NIE. And we have a lot of partners who are helping us with the transcription and now increasingly into the translation activity. These are four companies that are helping us with the transcription and translation. Transcription primarily by Desi Crew, But translation goes through all of these companies, Desi Crew, Bow and Ban, Mayflower and Crescendo. But yeah, so these are all people who make a difference in the sense that this transcript is what the students can download and then keep as course notes, or we use it for creating our subtitles. So all these processes are done by this transcript creation. And we know for a fact that a lot of students find it extremely useful because many of them, especially for the new course, when we have released the course and we are, you know, fighting deadlines to get the transcript in also at the same time, often if we are behind by even a week, we get a lot of messages saying, you know, we need the transcript kind of thing. So we know that it is a very useful for the student community. We now request Professor Anand to come and address the gathering. Professor Anand needs not much of an introduction, former director of IIT Madras, and he's been extremely instrumental in starting this program. I think the foresight, you know, almost 20 years ago to think that some program of this nature could have an impact on the nation takes a lot of, you know, understanding of the educational process, and we have to be very grateful to him for having started this program.
Thanks a lot. Bharti, Andrew and Pratap have given you breaking news. I have to give you only news that broke long ago, 20 years ago. Now, I must say that when we started this program, there was a tremendous dearth of teachers everywhere, and that's true even now. But the original plan of the program in 1999, the proposal we made, was to develop about 600 courses and then start a virtual university. That hasn't happened. I don't know when it'll happen. Recently, the secretary asked me if I would come and chair this, and I said, no, you have to find people who are 50, 55, and I'm all of 72. There's no point in asking me to start anything now. But I just have to tell you a few things about this. When we started with both video and web courses. I think the web courses are sort of dropping off now. And I must say, Professor Murli Manohar Joshi, who was then the minister, was very perceptive. He said, we want only video courses. You go ahead, if you insist, you can do some web courses, but video courses are the ones that will be useful because especially for rural students, he said, the face of the teacher is important. And he also said he will create a channel called Ekalavya. And he said, because Ekalavya was the first distance education student in mythology. And that was a rather perceptive statement. We started Ekalavya, but I remember in the initial stages, it was started very soon and we didn't have enough courses to run through Ekalavya. So we ran the same courses again and again. I remember going at lunchtime home and seeing Professor Srinivasan give his lecture on VLSI. Every day I saw those lectures. In fact, I learned a bit about VLSI because of sheer repetition. I think the reception has been extremely good. A lot of faculty help from all IITs. Professor Mangal Sundar, of course, has put in the maximum amount of work. But there was Professor Kushal Sen, and there was also Professor A.K. Ray from IIT Kharagpur. A.K. Ray had done this in IIT Delhi before, but not in the scale. But it really caught fire. A lot of people have helped, and I must say that the universities and the colleges have been extremely helpful. We made it a point that this was a service that we would render to them, and we said the customer has to be pleased, otherwise this won't take off. And we called a lot of teachers, and the amount of constructive criticism we got in those days, I'm really thankful to a lot of principals and teachers who gave us constructive criticism for the courses, and that helped. And this is the only program in which it's done to a syllabus. You know, we drew up a syllabus that was common from many universities, put it together, and if you look at OCW, which actually started the same time, 99, was when Chuck West in MIT made this proposal, only he didn't have to wait for money. We had to wait 4 years for money. In 2003, we got money, and this is not a complaint. I think if I sat in that seat, I'd behave the same way. So it's simply because they have to be sure that the program will work, that they're going to give us money, and so on. So initially, we received 26 crores, which they said was a lot of money. And then we received 94 crores in phase two. And then now I won't even try to guess. But I think the money is much more. But I think the major thing is the participation on both sides. And I'm very happy that the present team is carrying this forward so dynamically, and the local chapters, I think, are a great help. The feedback that the local chapters have given, I think, has been very useful for the NPTEL team. I must only add, I want to quote from Lewis, not the exact words. Lewis is a great chemist, and his preface to his book, he says, you visited ancient monuments and you're overawed by their perfection and their completeness. And he said, but think back about the time when they were actually being constructed. He said, you would have seen the scaffolding, you would have seen the workers working, the workers cursing, using words that are not parliamentary. Of course, now in the parliament, everything goes. But he said, then you realize that these monuments are the result of ordinary human effort given a direction and purpose. I think in a sense, once the direction and purpose was set, a lot of people participated and contributed to it. So you can't undermine anybody's contribution. For example, YouTube, when they first offered us, there was a strong objection saying YouTube has a lot of objectionable material. I said that material exists anyway, so let's try adding this, our bit. And then it turned out the first year, the maximum hits were on the NPTEL courses in YouTube. In fact, YouTube gave us that feedback. They've been, of course, very nice because they took away advertisements and made it available. Anyway, I just want to congratulate the present team. I want to congratulate all of you for the participation. I want to thank Dr. Dharaswamy for coming here, because a vice chancellor coming here immediately gives an impetus to the whole program. And we're very grateful to him that he's been able to come here and spare his time. And I'm hoping that this will go forward and we will have a virtual university soon. And the virtual university, we had a workshop in 99 in which I want to remind TCS and other people, four of the IT companies promised to do the administration of the virtual university because they are much better at it than we are. And then we can confine ourselves to teaching the courses, setting the exams and so on, and prescribing what should go into giving a degree. And I think that we are all right at. And hopefully it will be a cooperative program. And incidentally, the IT secretary at that time came here in 99 and he promised non-interference. He promised benign neglect, which is what we want from the government, really. We want money and then benign neglect. Because eventually, if they go on interfering with us, you have problems in all the universities. That's why the state universities are in such bad shape. They are improving, but if the interference decreases, then they will take off again. So I'm hoping it will happen. I'm hoping that we as a country will soon have a very large contribution to make in the education scene as well. Because from NPTEL, it's clear that many of our teachers are very good. In fact, some of the letter emails that come are really flattering. They say, one person said about one of the teachers, what you taught in 4 lectures, my professor has been struggling to teach for 15 lectures. In 15 lectures, this is from Chicago. And from MIT, somebody, and Stanford, somebody said, the quantum mechanics lectures are the best we have ever heard. And I don't know how you do it so systematically. So we've had a tradition of teaching, and I think we are reasonably good teachers. We can take pride in it. What we would like, I hope I'm speaking on behalf of the present team, what we would like is more teachers from other colleges giving courses. I mean, there's some discipline involved and a lot of effort involved, but I think if they put it in, then it'll be a complete cooperative effort. We already have courses, but not enough. I'd like to see more. So let me wish you all the very best. I have another board meeting to go to. So I'll have to excuse myself, and I want to just congratulate the present team and congratulate all of you for coming here, and thank Professor Dharaswamy for being here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Anand. The next address will be by our chief guest of the day, Dr. P. Dharaswamy, Vice Chancellor of Madras University. Professor Dharaswamy is an alumnus of the prestigious varsity and former head of Econometrics Department of University of Madras. He is a member of the UGC Peer Review Committee for Colleges and University and NAC Appeals Committee too. After completing his PhD in 1989, Professor Dharaswamy obtained another doctorate in economic science from the University of Paris in 2007. He was Sir Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan National Fellow of the Indian Council of Social Science Research and was affiliated to the Madras Institute of Development Studies. His collaborative research with the World Bank provided key inputs for major program initiatives such as the District Primary Education Program, and he has also been the Director of Planning and Development, Dean Academic and Chairperson of the School of Economics. During his academic career spanning 28 years, Dr. Dharaswamy has been a visiting professor of the University of Paris and a visiting fellow of Yale University. He has also received several honors and awards apart from completing several research projects sponsored by UGC, DRDO, UNDP and Rockefeller Foundation. He has published more than 70 research articles in reputed national and international journals with high impact factors, and his recent works on the grounds of economics of higher education in India. His other specializations include macroeconomics, political choice and voting behavior. Sir, I request you to kindly come on stage and deliver the chief guest address.
A very good morning to one and all present here. I am indeed very happy to be here to felicitate and also interact with the coordinators of the NPTEL local chapters. In fact, when Ms. Bharati wrote to me asking whether I can come and felicitate the local chapters, I immediately agreed. The main reason is that we are going in a big way to promote online courses and also adopt this NPTEL same courses. So I thought that this will be, this interaction and this meeting will be very useful for the University of Madras. That's the main reason that I have come here. So I'm very happy that Professor Andrew Thangaraj and Pradap Hari has made an excellent presentation and put forth mind-blowing numbers. I'm going to talk about that, what is happening the other side of the campus, like in the universities in Tamil Nadu and other parts of the country. I'm also very much thankful to Distinguished Administrator Professor Anand for giving the background of this NPTEL program. Professor Mangal Sundar has been in our committees. We have been running an online program for Pan-African countries, so over a decade. So Professor Mangal Sundar has been helping us to design the program and also run the program. Then, now that's, so when I took over as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Madras, I got an email from, I think, Professor Andrew, saying that they asked me an appointment to meet me. Then the immediately said that yes, we'll meet the very next day. Then the NPTEL meet me very next day at Bharati and Pradhof. And then they just showed few slides. I told them that, you know, this is what I am looking for. What I want is that you have to give an orientation for our college principals first, and also our teachers. Then immediately they agreed. Then we have organized a workshop in which they have made a presentation. There are a lot of a lot of people came forward to know more about this and also participate in the Swayam and NPTEL programs. So this the UGC has come out with the MOOCs regulation 2016. So as per this UGC regulation, the universities can change the regulation to include credits as part of the credits earned through Swayam and NPTEL courses as part of the degree programs. So Madras University is the first university in Tamil Nadu to modify its academic course regulations. And now the students of Madras University, not only in the university departments, in the affiliated colleges, as well as in the affiliated autonomous, non-autonomous colleges, as well as our distance education program, can choose 20% of their credits from the Swayam and NPTEL platform. And the credits they earn will be transferred and included part of the degree. Then we have also made other provisions that they can credit more, they can do more courses than they required for awarding the degree. So this will give an opportunity for the students of the Madras University, and as well as the college students to do more than the minimum required of 90 credits for PG and 140 credits for UG. And we will take the best of courses. And the CGPA is calculated based on the best performance in the courses. Either it may be from the online course or from the regular courses. So all the regular courses will be continued. And along with that, the students can choose the online courses. Then there are a couple of other developments. Now UGC has come out with a regulation for offering online degree programs. So Madras University is one of the few universities in the country which is eligible to offer online degree programs, and we have already formulated our regulations for online degree programs, and it was approved by our Senate. So we are waiting for the UGC's approval to run this program. Perhaps in another 1 month or in 6 weeks, this the UGC will announce and we will apply. And once they get the UGC approval, we will also run online degree programs. So in this online degree programs also, the courses offered through SWAYAM and NPTEL program can be part of our program. That is, this NPTEL program, to tell you that anybody can take this course and there is no copyright, you can download. And many of our faculty members also downloading and using as part of our lectures. It need not be that you have to use the whole course material. You can take even the particular chapter and blend with your own lectures and use it. So similarly, for our online programs also, we are going to allow the students to credit whatever credit they earn through this platform will form part of the requirement for the degree. You have seen the numbers shown by Mr. Andrew and Mr. Pradhaav. This is just nothing that they only 9% are taking the exams, and about 2%. No, only 2% are taking for the credits. It is not. It is the story. The scenario is going to completely change, even starting from this year. This academic year, 2018-19, then we have changed the regulation and other things. The students are going to credit register for these courses in a big way, maybe starting the 1 or 2 semesters from now. So this the enrollment in these courses are going to be an exponential growth because these are the best courses. It's taught by the best faculty. This is to overcome the faculty shortage in the universities and colleges. Even you know that the nearly 70% of the colleges in this country are run by the private trusts on self-financing mode. So we know that how the quality of the faculty in self-financing colleges. So the only way to overcome the faculty shortage as well as the faculty quality improvement and overall improving the all our programs, not only in engineering and other subjects, professional subjects, but also in arts, science, commerce, and other courses, then this is the only way to do it, that the NPTEL and the SWAYAM platform with courses being offered. So many of the faculty members in Madras University also are willing to be part of this offering these courses. Then one more information which I would like to share with you is that UGC has recognized the University of Madras one of the National Resource Center for training program for teachers, and UGC has identified about 10 centers in India for various subjects. So for Madras University, the UGC has allotted this politics and international studies. So Professor Andrew is in the Academic Council and Advisory Committee. So we need technical input from NPTEL team because it's basically an arts science university. I'm sure that we have a close association with IIT over the last 2-3 decades. For running some of our programs and also strengthening our computing skills, computers, this. So every time we start a new initiative, then we call experts from IIT first, then Anna University. So in this way, we are planning to go in a massive way, promote the online courses as well as our distance education programs with video lectures and other materials from online. The other information which I would like to share with you is that Madras University has made a common syllabus for the regular teaching in the affiliated colleges as well as our distance programs. The advantage is one can move from one to the other, from the regular program to the distance education if there is some family disruption or some other reason. And similarly, one can move the other way also, from the distance education to regular, so as a lateral entry. And then The other advantage is that in many of the self-financing colleges, the courses are not taught well. So our video lectures will help these students to improve their knowledge in the subject and also improve their performance in the exams. So these are the some of the things we have proposed, and this NPTEL and SWAYAM courses are an integral part of this, all our initiatives. So thank you very much for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to share some of the things which what is happening in the universities. So your the growth is going to be manifold, and it may be very difficult to manage this large number of students enrolling in these courses. I'm sure that IITs can manage this, and other leading universities like Madras University will be part of this kind of programs. Thank you so much.
So thank you, sir, for giving those updates about Madras University. In this connection, I would like to say he is one of the very few VCs that we got an instant response from. We wrote a mail to him. By that night, we had a reply. It was not through a secretary. It was not through a director's office. Somebody communicating directly, he was replying to us. And we were like, oh, wow. You know, that was the level of connect we had. Within a day, we got an appointment. And as he said, he asked us to present in a group of principals of the local arts and science colleges who had come, affiliated to Madras University. The interaction was so positive and so enthusiastic, you know. I mean, we totally didn't expect it. So many questions. They were just bombarding us with, you know, what about this, what about that, we didn't expect that kind of a reaction. And it was very encouraging to see the principals taking so much of an interest in, you know, knowing about the online courses, about seeing how to adopt it and so on. So we are very thankful to him for having called us and invited us over to that program. After this, we'll follow up with felicitating the top 10 local chapters, because Professor Duraiswamy has some other appointment after 11 and he has to leave. So I would request the top 10 local chapters, whoever is available here, to be kindly ready so that we can call you on stage and felicitate you. To give Professor Duraiswamy just a brief overview, we'll talk about it actually in much greater detail later on. We've started rating our local chapters based on their performance in the exams for every semester. So we take cognizance of how many candidates from every college actually participated, wrote exams in the courses, how well they did. We have a formula for it, which all of you are aware of, which we shall discuss later. And based on that, we rank our local chapters. So we have currently a top 100 followed by some active local chapters. So this time, based on the ranking that we have put out, we'd like to invite the Dean Academic as well as the SPOC, Professor Arul Kumar of Madanapalli Institute of Technology and Science, to kindly come on stage. They have been rated as a AAA local chapter. So they have been consistently coming, I think, in the AAA category last three times. They were on number three, number four, and so on. But this time they are on number one, so congratulations to them. Madanapalli is a small town, I think 2 hours from Tirupati. So they have been constantly striving, one of the early adopters of the certification for credit transfer. They had implemented it, and they have a lot of students actually going through programs for credit transfer. They have, in fact, I think third year, second year, all of them doing it. So that is there. Okay, some stats about them. Their participation in the exams was about 2,441. Those who completed 1,843. Elite category was 227, one gold, 40 toppers. So this is Madanapalli Institute. I would like to just call out the other names, though they're not here. The second was Institute of Engineering and Management, Kolkata, West Bengal. And they had about 655 candidates present. But as you can see, the number of toppers and the gold are much higher here. We have with us Professor Shanta Selva Kumari. Again, a consistent in the AAA category. They are from MEPCO Schlenk Engineering College, Shivagasi, Tamil Nadu. They had 1,417 students present, successfully completed 759. Gold 9, toppers 28. So again, madam has been with us for the last 4 years, I think from the first ever exam that we ran, a constant supporter who has been in touch with us. Thank you, ma'am. The next we would like to call upon YMCA University of Science and Technology, Faridabad, Haryana. I guess we'll meet them in the IIT Kanpur workshop. Valchand Institute of Technology, which will be the Bombay workshop that we'll get to meet them. So they were the top college last time. Then SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Kanchipuram, Tamil Nadu. I think the SPOC has not come today, but they are also here. Then we'd like to call upon Professor Rajesh and the principal and Professor M.V. Ratna Prasad to receive the award on behalf of Velagapudi Ramakrishna Siddhartha Engineering College, Vijayawada. They had 963 candidates present, 345 in the elite category, 5 gold and 17 toppers. The next is lovely professional university, Pagwara, Punjab. I guess they'll participate in the Kanpur workshop. We'd like to call upon Laki Reddy Bali Reddy College of Engineering. The SPOC for that is Professor Pavan Chand. This is again from Mailavaram, Andhra Pradesh. The number of present is 877 candidates, 200 elite, 5 gold, 18 toppers. We'd like to call upon Professor Deepa of Ramakrishna Engineering College, Coimbatore. They've had 699 candidates present, 278 successful, 335 elite, 15 gold, 19 toppers. So they also are in the AAA category of local chapters. So these are the 10 colleges that have been rated AAA for this particular semester, January to April 2018. We will carry on with the other categories after our next session. I would like to now we'd like to thank Professor Durasamy for his participation, for taking time off to be here, for sharing some inputs on Madras University, and we hope the relationship with Madras University can be continued in a big way. So thank you, sir. A small gesture from our side. Thank you for coming. And if you're wondering who the other person on the stage is who we've not introduced so far, that is Professor Niket Kaisare. He is also an additional coordinator of NPTEL now, because we are expanding, we have to expand our side of the committee also. So he is also getting added as an NPTEL coordinator of IIT Madras from this run on. So Professor Durasamy, I'd just like to say here, we have, how many arts and science colleges representatives do we have here? So we have quite a few of them actually here. Maybe not are all affiliated to Madras University, but they are. So one request that they keep coming up with is the courses that we offer from NPTEL side is a little high for them on the UG, students and all that which comes. So we're telling them, send us the syllabus, we'll look into it, we'll see how to tailor it. So some help, we'd really appreciate from that we can work with faculty and get it tailored more to those colleges also, so that they can also participate better in our courses. So Madras University affiliated colleges. So anyway, since we are ahead of schedule, probably we can get through to the next part before we break for tea. Pratap, you want to do this? Okay.
So we would like to share some more information about local chapters. This is a program primarily for the local chapters. So you can see the idea of it has been always to connect the NPTEL office and the students of the college in a sort of seamless way, in a manner that really enables the benefit for the students. So you can see we have a very large number of local chapters. It's actually crossed 1,800 now, spread across various states. You can see 65 in Gujarat. We have Maharashtra with 323, Tamil Nadu with 306. So those are pretty large numbers. Uttar Pradesh is 342. So those are three states which have extremely large numbers of local chapters. If you see, as a result of this local chapter formation, one of the things that we've really seen happen over the few exam runs that we have done is that we have sort of stabilized at nearly 75% participation in the exam registration as something that is coming from the local chapters. So that shows how strongly the local chapters participate in this process and how important they are for this NPTEL educational community kind of activity that we do. And this has really stabilized. You can see the numbers initially fluctuating, but we are now sitting around 75%. You can see from this map that it is really spread across various states. We just have a few states where we have not really yet made much of an impact. But many of the other states, we have a lot of impact. That percentage is the percentage of exam registrations that have come from those respective local chapters. And the next number that you see there in the lower line is the number of workshops that we have conducted there. And the last number you see is the number of local chapters. Of course, generally, as we conduct more workshops, we end up seeing lot more of the local chapters. But you can see that we have large numbers in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. West Bengal has increased exam registration in the last three semesters. We believe significantly because of this local chapter activity. Yes, thanks to Mr. Das, who is here. He has actually worked very hard in that area, and this is one thing that we should really appreciate here. Aspect that we see as an NPTEL activity is that we would like it to be uniformly beneficial to people all over the country. Of course, local offices of NPTEL make a huge difference in enabling this to happen. Otherwise, it's just a few of us running all around the country, and so there's only, we get limited by logistics. And Mr. Das has made a huge difference in the western part of India, eastern part of India. You can see also that we don't have, I mean, we're trying to still understand what's happening with respect to local chapters and how it makes an impact. So for example, in Maharashtra, we have a very large number of local chapters, but somehow the exam registration has been low. So that's something that we are still working on. So sometimes people sign up, but they don't necessarily do a lot. So that is why we are particularly grateful to the community that is here today, because you're all representatives of local chapters who are also doing a lot in your college to enable this to be very successful. So we take this opportunity to thank you for really putting in this effort on behalf of NPTEL. In terms of exams, again, exam activity has a, we have really grown in all the activities that we have done since we started out. And every time we have seriously looked at what is relevant in the Indian context, and a proctored exam seems to be an extremely important aspect of being relevant in the Indian context. So if you can see that in April 2018, we had 114 centers on for those exams across India. And of course, TCS ION is the one that was setting up most of these exam centers. For each of these exam centers, we have a representative from NPTEL office who is present there physically one day before the exam and on the exam day to ensure that all arrangements are run correctly. We try to mimic all operations from exams such as GATE and JEE, which have been established over many years. Every aspect that they have fine-tuned to get the exam process right is something that we are also adopting. We also understand the importance that, we are trying to reach out to the public across the country. So that is our primary purpose. So numbers are, in a sense, secondary. The numbers will come. We are not really worried about the numbers. We do our job, the numbers will come. So we make a lot of effort to ensure that we reach out to places which are remote. In fact, remote places are even more important to us, because in bigger cities and better equipped towns, people will somehow find a way. I mean, if you set up something reasonable, they will find a way to reach that place. We don't have to really get worked up about the exact detail of the arrangement. But there are many other places, Srinagar, Dumka, a lot of other places, Shillong, Dimapur, so many other places where maybe the infrastructure is not that good, and then and therefore it may not be as easy or comfortable to set up an examination process there. And of course, TCS ION is running it on a commercial basis, so they may have some restrictions on their ability to run it in some of these little bit remote places where they may not be seeing regular numbers for various exams in those areas. But for us, these are important places, so we make effort to ensure that the students here are not deprived. So we run what we call offline exams, which are non-TCS based exams at these centers, so that these students are not in any way impacted due to the lack of infrastructure there. So they write the same exams that other students in other centers are writing, except they do it in an offline mode, and then we handle it post the examination. So some more changes that have happened in the recent past is that now every course that we have on NPTEL is a SWAYAM course. So this is a question that probably comes up to you, and maybe even many of you might have, as to what is SWAYAM, what is NPTEL, and so on. So SWAYAM is a larger umbrella activity, also funded by MHRD, primary and MHRD activity, mainly to get digital education to the public in a larger scale. In this context, NPTEL has been the most experienced participant of SWAYAM. We are an integral part of SWAYAM, and we are the most experienced participant of SWAYAM. And therefore, many of the processes that you see in SWAYAM sort of initiated from where, from with respect to what NPTEL was carrying out. And we are very proud and happy that we are the part of SWAYAM. And so every NPTEL course is a SWAYAM course. So if you see a notification that says that a SWAYAM course can be used for a following purpose, say maybe for credit transfer, SWAYAM courses can be used for credit transfer, every NPTEL course is a SWAYAM course. So if you take an NPTEL course, you are taking a SWAYAM course, the student is taking a SWAYAM course. So our certificates now carry the SWAYAM logo. All the people who got certificates in this, nearly 80,000 students who got certificates this recent past examination, have all received SWAYAM certificates. We also, at the back of this certificate, we have a QR code, which has been on since July 2017. And so if you just have a QR code reader on your mobile phone even, you can scan that QR code and it will show you the e-certificate on our site. So that's the security feature that we have there. And so that's also something that we have put on our certificate. So something on ratings and recognition process that we have done. So this is something that we've maintained over a period of time. So this is just to reiterate what we are doing. So we have tried to balance the online learning process, the self-directed online learning process, with the proctored final exam process. So we have 25% weightage for the assignment score. So this is something that you're all familiar with, and 75% weightage for the proctored, in-person final examination. And we have also, even for the assignments, we are having, we are doing best 3 out of 4, best 6 out of 8, or best 8 out of 12, primarily to give the students some flexibility. So they have some off 1 week, they are not up to some activity, and they are busy with some other activity, they are unable to attend to this, they don't terribly lose out of on it. And as I mentioned earlier, we have also worked with our faculty to create an exam process that better captures the learning that the students have done during through the assignments. And therefore, somebody who has actually done 8 out of 12 assignments, and ideally, in fact, 12 out of 12 assignments, has a very good chance of getting a pretty good certificate from NPTEL. So our existing process, which we have been maintaining, is that less than 40%, we don't give a certificate. So we do not give any participation certificate, so to speak. 40 to 59% gets a successfully completed certificate. If it's over 60 and less than 90, it's an elite certificate. And greater than 90, they get an elite plus a gold medal tag. So some of the things that we are looking at is going forward, which we have not made any decisions on, and we would be happy to receive feedback from you. We are thinking of whether it makes sense to increase the cutoff for the passing, for a student to be declared as passed. So maybe from instead of 40, if it makes sense to do with 50. We do a lot of studies on the statistics that we have obtained. I mean, so this is based, this is not arbitrarily being considered. We're really looking at all the, because we now have, several lakh students who have actually completed the course, got a certificate from us. So it's pretty elaborate data is available to us from which we can, even share with on a general basis, but through which we are making some judgment on what is the possibilities that we have with respect to fine-tuning this even further. But for now, this is the process, so we will keep you posted in case there is any change, if there is any change. So we have we have a logic for toppers. So when we declare somebody as a topper, we have some process for this thing. So if there's some certain number of people who have been certified, and if for whatever reason it's a very specialized course, there are only 10 people who got the certificate, then only the person really ranked number one gets declared as the topper. If the number is between 10 and 50, then top two people in that course, first rank and second rank, get declared as toppers. Between 50 and 100, the top five in the course get declared as toppers. And if it's greater than 100, then we have actually different markings on the certificates. We have a top 1%, a top 2%, and a top 5% kind of marking. But we also say that all toppers have to get at least 60 marks. So they have to at least have an elite certificate to even be classified as a topper. So if for some magical reason there's a course where nobody gets over 60, then nobody is being declared as a topper, so to speak. And they get a topper seal on the certificate, and it is also showcased on our portal. So this is something that we do for our toppers. So this shows for a cloud computing course, all the toppers there. We always, of course, get their permission to put this up so that because this is going to be publicly visible. This top 1% of certified candidates, you can see that the spread that you see here consists of students, it consists of faculty, and it consists of industry people. So I think in terms of the reach of education and the sort of a leveling process that NPTEL has enabled, this is a great example of how that has been accomplished.
So we'll probably pause for a break here. So it's 11 o'clock. Two requests to the SPOCs. So one is that I already announced we have a feedback form for you all to fill up. This is a survey that we periodically conduct. We had done it about a year back, but a lot of policies might have changed within your institute. The way you've adopted the courses, the impact of the certificates on the candidates have taken, it might have changed. We want to collect some feedback from you all regarding all these data points. It's just a plain Google form. You can go to nptel.ac.in/localchapter and fill up the form for us. So in the next 15-minute break, if I'll finish your coffee snacks, you have 5 minutes time, request you to do this survey for us. The other one is also we are collecting video feedback. So we do collect video feedback after the exams outside the centers, but that is anybody. But we want specific feedback from the SPOCs to say, how is NPTEL being received within your college? What is the problem points that you all face? Any recommendations you'll have, suggestions you have? again, the same thing on video, like the firm might say that, yes, so many people got internships. Do you have any stories to share with us? Do you have any candid information to share with us? I'll take 2 minutes here because we've had a lot of stats. I'll share 2 stories here. So there were 2 things which we had shared with the SPOCs, but I'm not too sure if you saw the video. So one nice thing about the impact we keep getting is, oh, yes, I got an internship. I got a job. I got this. So many people got qualified. And we do get those emails. But there was one specific feedback. We had gone to Gandhinagar recently for a workshop, and the SPOC of a college there shared something which we thought really, I mean, touched us that day when he said it on stage. So I said, you have to make a video and send it to us because we want to showcase this. So it was only about 3 specific students inside their college, and it was about a person who was kind of, I would say, soft skill challenge, if you can say that, or communication challenge. I don't know the term to use for that. So the SPOC was saying that person would not look at anybody in the face in the college. He's in an engineering stream. He would not look at anybody's face and talk to the person. You even ask him for his father's name, he will not say it. He will just be looking somewhere. He will look down. He will not even look at you. He was failing in his college and so on. So at one point, this NPTEL talk came up. He said, he told the student, why don't you try this? And we are going home for summer and look at it. The student came back after 6 months. He comes with 2 certifications and says, I did very well. And then he said, I want to go in for more. He did one more semester and he came back. And he said, he sat across me from the table and for 15 minutes and talked with me. That was a big achievement because this was a boy none of us could reach out to. So the confidence of the courses, you know, which brought him up to say, I could score well, I have done courses well, that was something. There was another girl he was saying who was consistently failing. She had some 8 arrears, this, and you know, she was not being able to cope, again, an engineering student there. And he recommended, why don't you do NPTEL courses? So she was like, you know, in this college itself, I'm not able to do it, how will I do it? He said, just try, it doesn't hurt you to do it. But then she came back after a semester and said, I got some 65% or something. Then he said, why 65? How many hours did you spend per day? And she said, I spent like 3 hours per week or something. He said, maybe put in 5 hours and you will get a gold. And he said, the girl went back, he didn't see her for a few months. She comes back the next run, sir, I got a gold certificate. She is a person who has failed in some 8 subjects, has arrears. So he was saying how NPTEL helped this. A professor who delivers a lecture in class, you cannot do a rewind and a pause and replay, right? You can't tell him to teach you 5 times. In an NPTEL video, you can do that. We have notes, we have assignments, you can take the help. People can watch it at their own pace. Even for the boy who could not communicate, there was not a teacher in the class who would say, hey, get up and answer my question, because he was not comfortable with that. In an NPTEL video, I don't have to answer anybody, I'm not being questioned about anything. You just do the course at your own pace and in your own style. So this was again a girl who got a confidence, and now she's so much better placed. You were saying, yes, I can do anything. If from IIT I've gotten this, I do have, you know, I can do it. I just have to probably change my style of learning. And the third one he was saying, which was an eye-opener, which I think many SPOCs, and we keep telling the students we meet, is many students say, sir, we don't have the time to do these courses. We already have so much load and I can't do it. There is a student from that college who has done 8 exams with us and wants to do more. So this SPOC was shocked and he said, how are you managing it? Every time I talk to students, they say, I'm so busy, I don't have time, I have this. He was saying, this. He said, this was a student's input, every day, today on an average, the youngsters are spending 4 hours on a electronic device, be it a mobile, be it a tablet, be it a computer, browsing, social media, whatever be it. So he said, I cut it down. I said, 1 hour will be for that, 3 hours I'm going to put in for NPTEL. And he says, it's so easy. You don't require anything more than that. That's all you need to do. So the SPOC says, nowadays I go and tell people saying that, you know, just cut down your time that you're spending on other sites. Come to NPTEL, study. You can easily do your courses. So some feedback like this. If you'll have any stories within your college, there's a college that we went within Kerala, one interior rural from the main road. I think we went some 2 hours inside. It was like almost in a village setting. We were doing a workshop there and we went. And there, for the last 20 years, they've not had internships for students in like... till I think third year or even the 7th semester they were saying. And for the first time, that time when we went, she said a girl had gotten an internship after 2nd year at Ernst & Young, which was because she had done 2 courses from us on some financial management and another management thing. She had showcased it, she had talked about it, and she got an internship. They were so proud about it that Ernst & Young, their college, one student had got, and now she's becoming the inspiration for the next, you know, students to come, that this is possible if you do it. Another thing that we had from Valchand, we had gone to Valchand Institute in Solapur for a workshop again. There what happened is we were going for tea and there were 20 students sitting up, well dressed and all. So we said, oh, what's happening? They said, no, recruitment is happening. There's some company that has come in from Hyderabad and they are interviewing all of them. So we just walked by and within an hour, as we were doing the workshop, the SPOC came and announced saying that most of them had gotten jobs with the company. And we said, so we were like, okay, why is he even announcing it here in this forum and the workshop is going on? Then he says, when they went into the interview, they asked him, it seems, do you have these, do you know Java, do you know this? They said, no, we have not learned it in the college. Then they said, do you know Python? Yes, I've done it from NPTEL, show a certificate. Do you know something else? Yes, we've done it, show a certificate. So he said, what worked there, which our college had not done as courses for them, was the NPTEL certification that they were showing to him. They were questioned on it and they got jobs that day. This was a live example we actually saw there. We were there at the workshop doing it. 1 hour before we saw candidates, 1 hour later we get news that they're all getting letters of recruitment. So some things like this which makes us really happy, and you know, worth our while when we get so many things that don't work for us, we get all calls that keep shouting at us, scolding us, you guys are not doing well. We also mess up a lot, I know that. But you know, when all these things don't work for us, the things that keep us going is some feedback like this, the emails that we see, the, you know, some things that change in somebody's life that has actually worked because of these courses. So if y'all could share any stories from inside your college for us that we could showcase and use somewhere, that would be really great. We have two set of studio teams waiting outside, so you all could share feedback. Lunchtime also will be there, post-lunch also will be there, but if you'll have time, you can do that. And please fill up this survey for us. So I'll just wait for Pratap and Andrew to come. Okay, Andrew's here. So I'll, Andrew, can you come on stage, please? So I'd like to call Ramkumar onto the stage. So he is with TCS ION, one of our primary contacts for conducting the exam. Miss Cynthia is not here with us today. Otherwise, Miss Cynthia, Ramkumar, and our current manager is Arvind. So they three help us with coordination of activities for the entire exam run. So Ram always does this vanishing act when we say that, you know, colleges can interact with him and give him feedback and inputs on how to partner. But he says he has to leave now. So if any of the colleges want to become a TCS center in places that is not there, want to partner with them to be able to conduct exams within your college, we can connect you to them. Beyond that, our interaction stops. So beyond that, it is up to TCS ION to certify the college and have agreements with them, and however they work, the modalities is between the college management, between the college management and TCS ION. So thanks Ram for 4 years of support. We hope that this will really continue. And the first exam in July 2014, we had done it in 10 cities. Today, we are doing it in about 100 cities with about 120 centers. All thanks to them that we are also scaling up. You want to?
Good morning to all of you. You know, it's a very proud moment. Always, you know, it's a working relationship with NPTEL is very different because we do a lot of things which actually very, very different in terms of our regular process that TCS ION follows for any examination. So, in fact, we have grown a lot, learnt a lot together, and thanks to Professor Andrew, Professor Pratap and Bharti, because a lot of inputs used to come and which will, in fact, we have evolved also, you know, from where we used to be and from where we are today. So that's a very good experience, and it's a journey of customer and a business partner is a very good experience we have it with NPTEL. So, and I think I'm meeting all of you for, I think, third or fourth time. You know, every year they conduct a program like this, as I make sure that at least I make my presence for a few minutes, though there could be some other activities which are involved. So today also, you know, there are a few other, you know, engagements which are already planned, but still I had made sure that I should be present for, you know, to meet all of you, if possible, to, you know, say hi to all of you. So a quick note on the process which Professor wanted us to highlight is, any institute wants to participate or want to become an examination center for TCS, that is possible. Or you need to have sufficient infrastructure. Is when we say infrastructure, the computer labs with good power backup, UPS, genset, all this, and a very good network, you know, LAN connectivity and stuff. This is a very fundamental requirement. Whereas system requirements are different, which we can one-to-one, we can connect. If they are interested, they can connect with us, they can write to us by mail, they can reach out to us. And our local teams in local locations, this is more of south, right? This is the entire crowd will be more of south. So we have our presence, our TCS ION team members are available across almost in all the districts. So I'm not even talking about Tamil Nadu, across all states, states. So you can write to us, we'll connect with the right set of people to come to your institution. They will make a relevant technical check and or they can even suggest what all changes that is required. If it is readily, you know, kind of consumable, they may also consume it. As well as there is other component, which is the memorandum which they generally sign up with the institutions, which the management of the college has to line up with TCS and mutually agree upon certain terms and conditions. So this is a set of process that we can follow, but we are already, many of this could be exam centers for us. If I understand, Madanapalli we have conducted exam, MEPCO we have conducted exam, National Engineering College we have conducted exam. Many colleges in this crowd itself we have conducted exam. For any other college, and if they are very keen or university is very keen to work with TCS, please don't hesitate, write to us, connect with us. We will tell what all the set of things that we need to go together, we have to do it together. We can do, and then you can also become a proud TCS partner for conducting an exam. It's not only for NPTEL, you can conduct exams. We conduct exams 365 days. In fact, I'm completely engaged today because some big exam is happening outside. So mind is completely occupied on that. So there are, so you can always work with us very closely, and you can become our partner as well on this. So my email ID, phone numbers may be there with you, or you can write to NPTEL office and take my details. You can connect with me offline. We can stay connected and take the relationship forward. So thanks so much, Professor Andrew Pratap and Bharti, for acknowledging every year. They don't forget whether we do something, whatever we do, they make sure that they acknowledge us, and very kind gesture. Thank you so much. Thanks to all. Bye.
We'd like to call upon Mr. Suresh, who works in the Office of Alumni Affairs. He in fact heads the whole alumni cell at IIT Madras. It is through their office that the entire CSR money gets routed. So the Arisan funding and any other help, they in fact help us connect with a lot of alumni who are interested in partnering with us possibly and so on. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank him for all the passing of papers, giving us connects, and hope that more connects come so that, the fee waiver can be upped on our side in terms of contribution. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming today. We already acknowledged transcription partners. I see Mr. Manivannan here of Desi Crew Solutions. I would like you to please come on stage. So he's heads the company Desi Crew Solutions Private Limited. We have been working with them since 2010. It's been 8 years that we've been working with them. They were one of the first to even start. We didn't have any processes of how to transcribe. They had to set up their cells. So they provide a lot of employment to people in Tier 2, Tier 3 cities, also taking this project across and so on. So thank you for being a constant partner and support for us over the last 8 years. And if you all see transcripts coming for new courses week after week in this semester, it is also thanks to their efforts, because Monday nowadays we are giving them videos telling them give us transcripts back on Thursday. We are trying to host it on Friday. So that's the timeline that they are also working. We are making them run as we run. So thanks, sir. Thanks for being here today. We have other distinguished guests, but I'll wait for some time before we again get on to introductions. We'll head on to probably the local chapter and ratings. How many SPOCs here are totally new to the process, that first time you're coming for an SPOC workshop? Okay, then it gives me some ground for going through these slides. I'd like to run through this. I am going to be talking fast because, yes, the time also keeps, clocking away. It never stops and we keep being rushed. So I'll just go through these slides. The rating of local chapters, as you all know, is based on the participation and performance of candidates from your college in the NPTEL exams. So here we are not rating the college per se, we are rating the performance of the NPTEL local chapter in your college. So and in this we include, the candidate can be anybody, it can be a student, it can be a faculty member, it can be any other staff member who's taken the exam, whoever it may be. We don't distinguish on the role of the person in the college. It could be anybody, and we take performance numbers into account. And here again, as you can see, we have devised a formula that we have been using for the last 2 years, which we will be revisiting. I'll show you some things that we are in the works. We have not yet finalized though. So currently it is the number present for the exams is being capped at 10 points, 0.1 for every person present, which means beyond 100, there is no additional points you're going to get for people being present to the exam. Then it's 1 point for every person who successfully completes the exam, that is passes the exam, getting a score above 40 to 59. 60 to 89, if you're an elite certificate holder, that candidate gets an equivalent points of 2 when we calculate in the rating formula, 10 points for a gold medalist and 20 for a topper. So this is what we've done, and last 2 years, again this semester too, we've had the top 10 local chapters to be getting a rating of AAA, then 11 to 50 is AA, and 51 to 100 this time we have a rating of A being given to that particular local chapter. So this rating will change every semester. As you see, we have published even the ratings of the last 4 semesters on the website. If you want to go back and look on how it has changed, that is also available. The next change rating will be after this, will be for the courses that happened between July to November 2018. For the top 100 local chapters, these are the kind of plaques that we are actually giving away that you can see lined up here, and the 10 that we first gave away. So this is for the college that we are giving it. So this is the college name, the city, state. This is the format that we have done. We keep changing the certificate so that it doesn't become bore and bland every semester that we run. Same type, you have 5. So we try to do some designing. So that's for a AAA, this is for a AA, and this is for a rating of A. Apart from this, do we stop there? Do we say only these 100 did something with us, the others didn't do anything with us? We absolutely don't want to get there. So we know that a lot of SPOCs are working behind the scenes, really trying to get the initiative pushed and kind of getting students to participate in the courses and write exams. So what we have is another category called active local chapter. So here we are saying that if you have at least 25 candidates present for an exam from your college, or if any of your students, you don't have the 25, but you have at least a topper or a gold medalist from your college, we would say it is because of the efforts of the SPOC. We want to recognize the SPOC there. So in that sense, we have an active local chapter. And this time for Jan semester, we have 452 active local chapters. The 100 rated local chapters automatically by default are active. So yes, we do tag them, but it's already understood. Apart from that, 452, we are giving certificates of appreciation to the SPOC alone. The college does not get anything in this sense, but the SPOCs get appreciation. So this is the split this time. They're based on participation alone. That is, at 25 candidates, we have 55 local chapters. Colleges that don't have 25 candidates but have a topper or a gold medalist, it is 161 local chapters. Those that have both is about 236. So this is what I said, that they get certificates. This is the kind of certificates that the SPOC gets, with the photograph, the name, the college name. This is for the 100 top rated local chapters. So this is the certificate that the SPOC gets. And this is the kind of certificates that the SPOCs of active colleges get. So most of you must have received it while you were registering itself. I hope it is with you. So this is also present. Okay, something that you might want to keep in mind when we open up the floor for discussion is, we are looking at how the rating is being done, because 2 years we've not revisited, numbers are increasing, local chapters are increasing. We want to see, is this criteria still valid? Do we want to relook the criteria and so on? So one of the things we were thinking of is, successfully completed, do we want to cap the numbers somewhere? So that is something we are looking at. Or the other one, since we always talk about performance of the candidates writing exams, do we want to count only the elite and above towards our local chapter ratings? So we are working on it. We have not finalized on what we are going to do for this semester. As you know, we keep experimenting. Yes, some work, some don't. So we will announce probably within the next 2 weeks or max month, saying what is it that we are going to use as criteria for the July-November semester. But it is likely to change. Let's debate on it when we come to the interaction session. SPOC also, many times you have found that the college is getting either a rating or they are being tagged as active. But then we find that we have never even interacted with the SPOC in some sense. We don't even know who they are. They've never written a mail to us. We've never been on interaction. So one of the things we want to put down as an SPOC is at least a base minimum of, are they logging into our portal? We want to check whether they are checking data. Do they even know that they are an SPOC and they are working for this? That is something. And if we run surveys, we want SPOCs to at least answer those surveys. So there's a base minimum we're thinking that we know that an SPOC is doing. You all might be doing a lot of groundwork on the other side, but sometimes we don't know it. So we thought at least we'll get this from your side. Okay, for mentors. Mentors has been, again, a huge support, and we've heard a lot of stories on how mentors are influencing the results of candidates within colleges. So for mentors also, we have a recognition formula, and this is the thing. A mentor will get a certificate in these scenarios. I'll just skip that. I'll give you some stats. This time, 4,301 mentors were nominated by the SPOCs. So the process that works is, mentors are course-specific for a particular run. While the SPOC is the boss for the NPTEL local chapter in the college, the mentor is only specific for a particular course in a particular run. Their role does not carry forward beyond that. So that is how a mentor works. And normally we expect the mentor to be a faculty member who knows the subject or can contribute to the learning of the candidates in that particular subject, or at least motivates and kind of enthuses the students to keep on to the course and write exams and so on. So 4,301 mentors were actually nominated. 1,103 were qualified to get certificates. So I guess certificates also have been handed over to you while you were registering. And a split for why the remaining did not get certificates is 2022 mentors, their mentees did not register for the exam. So the criteria for a mentor to get a certificate is not on his performance. We don't expect mentors to write exams and go through the course per se. That's not a criteria. But we check on the performances of the mentees. Whoever is attaching themselves to the mentor, we are checking how they are doing. So these mentees didn't even register for the exam. They registered but they were not present, or they did not do well in the exam. As an aside, 871 mentors took up the exam themselves, 50 were gold medalists. So this is a thing on the faculty front. Okay, so some things more we are bringing on the mentor front. So this is something that we thought, because we thought we were not capitalizing on what the mentors were providing as inputs to the student, and we want to reach out to that feedback too. For instance, say a mentor in a college is actually going through our course content along with the students. They are doing the assignments. They are also handling the students. They know where the problems in our courses are, what the gaps are, whether our assignments are pegged more difficult than what is there, whether the content does not match with what is given, maybe the forum has some issues. That is where the mentors really can help us and give suggestions, which we are not actively getting today. So one of the things we are trying to do is we will put out a feedback form. We did it about, I think, a year or two back, and it did not work well, but now we are going to kind of make it a little mandatory for getting certificates to say, give us feedback about the course. Tell us what were the aspects of the course that were, you know, difficult, gaps. Help us identify the problem points. Tell us what was nice. Tell us where we can, you know, add some content extra. So that one, we want mentors to fill up the form at least once a month. So for a 4-week course, it will be just once, 8-week course twice, and for a 12-week course, 3 times. And the other one is the mentors need to be enrolled to the portal for the course which they are mentoring. Okay, many times colleges come back and say, oh, our faculty members work behind the scenes and please give them certificates, but we are kind of tightening it now. Unless we don't see you all enrolled on the portal and we don't see mentees attached to your profile, we will not be able to give certificates. So that's something that we are saying here. One criteria which we want to revisit is, there is one point which says that if anybody has 10 students who appeared for the exam, but none of them passed actually, you still get a certificate. I think being a mentor, it kind of now hit us that, you know, these guys should be passing if they have a mentor and the mentor is actively mentoring them. Some of them should be passing it. So we are looking at revisiting this criteria. It may be removed from a mentor qualification certificate for the next time. We have not implemented it for the Jan run. These are the kind of certificates that mentors are getting currently. So we have these, we have top performing mentors. That is those whose mentees were gold medalists or toppers. Then we have those who had more than 100 mentees. Some badges we have given for mentors also. So I'll go through that. Okay, some tidbits that we wanted to show that we keep analyzing again is last year, for last 3 semesters, we have done some data check. So last March, which is you know, a year ahead exactly, number of people taking one exam was about 92% and 2 exams was about 7.2%. And if you see the 3 and 4 exams given there, it is just 0.69 and 0.31%. After a year, April 2018, we are finding that 1.09% is taking 4 exams. So they are actually, though April, you know, we got a lot of flack for it and feedback saying it was a bad date and you did back-to-back exams and it was a single date. There were actually 780 people who have done 4 exams on a weekend, Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon, Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, and they wanted to do it, they have done it. So this number is, the percentage is increasing with our increasing numbers, which means more and more people are going in for the courses and the exams. 3 exam people also, it's gone up to 2% from 0.6 and 0.8%. So we are seeing an increase in number of people taking more exams per semester. So that is something that we are finding. We wanted to see who these people were. So I, for those who have attended our previous SPOC sessions, we always say, you know, okay, September 2016, we had one person who wrote 4 exams and topped all 4. March 2017, one person who wrote 4 exams topped. This time, we had 12 candidates take up 4 exams or 3 exams, a topper in all 4 or all 3 exams taken. So this has gone up from 1 candidate to 12 candidates this particular semester. So this is the kind of outlay that we have. There is a mix of, I think, student, faculty and professionals also in this. People who have done 4 exams with us or 3 exams with us. And even the type of courses we wanted to check just to see how much time they would be spending. So the first person has done more of the, I wouldn't call it soft skill, but something related to teaching, research and so on. But the second and third people have done machine learning data sciences course, 4 exams, which means either they are looking for a job change, project change, or getting into some domain there, I don't know. And the other one is electrical engineering, all related. And they've topped all 5s. And these two are from Purpose Technology, probably a company, and Goa College of Engineering, a student. So this is something that we wanted to showcase. So I hope that SPOCs can actually, why are we saying this in this workshop? So when students come back and say, we don't have time, right? We can't write even one exam. Even that one is a problem for me. I won't do this. These are examples that are an inspiration that people who are working in organizations who are already, you know, probably stretching themselves 9 to 8 or something, doing 4 exams and topping the exams. What excuse more can we give to say that we can't do something, right? So I guess this goes back home to each of your students. The other data we wanted to showcase was this. We also did saying that do we have repeat candidates coming back to learn from us, or are they running away after the first course, okay? So that was something that we did. We are seeing that 5 courses, 764. I mean courses, I don't mean enrollment, I mean exam registrations. So people have done 5 exams with us, there are 764, 6 exams, 309, and you can see the last row in this table, 21 exams with us, there is 1%, 19 exams with us, 2 people. I don't even know if we ran so many dates or exam sessions, we'll have to really see how they manage it. That means from the first semester on, they've been doing 2 or 4, whatever, every semester. And again, we saw, okay, who are these people? So it is a student from Kongunadu College of Engineering and Technology. I don't know if it's an LC with us or the SPOC is here today, but there's a student who's done 21 exams with us. Then there is one employed person from DRDO, 19 exams. Employed from TS Genco, 19 exams. So faculty from Velamal Engineering College, Gunashekaran sir, we see him, he's a regular, he's there in our feedback and on 18 exams again. P. Ashok is actually an SPOC. Prince Sri Venkateshwar, I don't know if Ashok is here today. Okay, probably not attended. He has done 16 exams with us. So there are a lot of people here who have done multiple exams with us over the last 4 years. Okay, candidates from abroad. So as you all know, we don't have exams outside of India today. And if anybody for learning, it is free. People can from abroad can enroll to our courses, learn from our courses and so on. But the minute they say, how do I write exams? The only line we tell them is come to India, fly down to India, write our exams and go if you want a certificate. We don't have an option currently. We are stabilizing still in India. We look at doing it outside slowly. So in that context, we found that we had 2 candidates from South Africa who flew in to take exams. These were actually students. But the surprising part was there were 2 people from Applied Materials Company. They were getting promoted as project leads. And apparently their boss had told them, go do this NPTEL course from, NPTEL, write the exam and come back. It will help you with your project management. So I said, anyway, you've learned, why do you want a certificate? No, we are supposed to come back with certificates. So one came from Singapore, one came from Austin, Texas. They flew down to Bangalore, wrote our exam, took back our certificates, and they are there. In fact, the person from Austin, Texas told me, I was so liked your course that this time too, I'm in a course in your NPTEL thing. I'll come back this time too. So I said, yeah, most welcome. So this is something that we are seeing again. Credit transfer. Pratap Andrew, do you want to do it or should I go ahead?
Okay, so I think you heard VC sir also talk about it in the morning. Credit transfer, I think, is going to be increasingly important going forward. A lot of universities across the country are becoming more aware of it, the possibility of students being able to earn credits through this process. Now, both the UGC and AICTE have come out with clear gazette notifications which say the universities can do it. There is no problem there. Now, of course, when that is not, that's only the beginning. The next step is for the Board of Academic Studies or Academic Councils or whatever the equivalent is in every university has to meet and do it. So in case any of you need a copy of these gazette documents and all of that is available in our webpage. We can give them to you to help make a case. So invariably what happens is somebody in the college or university has to go meet somebody in the board of academic council and convince them that, you know, this is worth doing, a lot of people are doing it, people will benefit, and then push this a little forward. It's not easy. I think even in Madras University, for instance, while the academic council is approved, then there is the next step. The departments have to come up and say, you know, this is the list of courses every semester. And that, I think, is yet to happen, even for the July semester. So there is this constant push that is needed. I think if you are an affiliated college, SPOC from Madras University, please contact the concerned department and say, please give us a list of approved courses. So you have to push constantly to get these things going, you know, because university officials are busy. They have 101 things to do, and this is one more thing, and you have to push for that. So I will urge you to follow up on this. Don't be thinking that somebody will do it. Even if your university approves, if there is a process, make sure that the process is followed. Okay, don't let it slip. So IITs are doing it, and IITs, traditionally, these kind of things are a little bit easier. So in IIT Madras, for instance, students are free to pick their own courses, and then up to 3 courses they can get credit for their degree. And it's quite an easy process. They've come back with a certificate and apply for the credit transfer. 227 students from IIT Madras have taken this exam for credit transfer basis. So in case you need to justify this to your academic council, you can say even in IIT Madras, they're allowing their students to take it for credit. So this is not something which is supposed to be, it has a very high reputation and standard. There's no problem there. So this is happening in other IITs also. Quickly, we'll see other IITs following suit as well. So here is a few descriptions of what is possible, how a few universities have done it. And we can also share this with you in more detail later on. So for instance, Kerala Technical University and Gujarat Technical University are giving something called activity points to their students. Okay, so this is not credit, but this is something called activity points, which is mandatory for the degree anyway. So students can earn activity points through that. So if something like that is there, you can do it. UP Technical University and West Bengal Technical University, that is the one at the bottom, they are giving credit and they're also giving honors degree. Okay, for students who do enough online courses, they are giving an additional honors degree. So some BTech, instead of just saying BTech, it will say BTech honors. So that is from online courses. University of Madras has already approved it for credit, but like I said, there is a process that they have to follow. The departments have to recommend some courses, and then that has to happen. I believe it has not been implemented in one semester yet. Hopefully they will do that going forward. So different models are possible, and I think going forward, this will definitely happen. Different universities across the country will approve it in their own ways. And autonomous colleges are also approving it in large numbers. So I'm not talking about autonomous colleges here. I'm talking about universities doing this. So here is some implementation for autonomous colleges. There's a long list. And different colleges do their own method. And there need not be uniformity in how the credit transfer is done. I mean, as long as some credit is given, I think it's okay. Here is a list, larger list of courses, colleges. Yes, but this is what SPOCs have shared with us. So if you are an SPOC here, and if your college is an autonomous college, and you're taking it for credit in some form, please let us know. And if you're part of a university which is already accepted it for credit in some form, please let us know. The reason why I'm asking is a person from MHRD is also here. When we have high-level governing council meetings in MHRD, people ask us, is anyone taking your courses for credit? And we have to give a good answer there. If we give a good answer there, then more support will come for the program. So all these things are very important. So if you know that your students are benefiting from this program in any way, whatever way, please let us know. Keep the loop closed so that we can take the information back to policymakers. Okay. So here is more list. The list is quite long. I hope as you give us more inputs, the numbers will increase as well. So one of the things that is unique about NPTEL is we are not just happy doing whatever we are doing, and we are not sitting idle. Okay, so every day there is some new idea that comes, some new initiative that we try to do, or some initiative will be thrust on us from, say, the ministry or somebody. They'll say, okay, you have to do this, etc. Okay, so I'm going to talk about a few of the new initiatives. The first initiative I want to talk about is the integration of the Swayam portal and the NPTEL portal. Okay. It is something that has been in the plan for quite a long time, and we have identified a company which is going to take care of both the NPTEL portal and the Swayam portal. Maybe this is a good time to introduce them. The company is called Persistent Systems. They are a Pune-based company. Maybe Shekhar should stand up. Shekhar and Mahesh. Yeah, maybe you should come up on stage. Yeah. So for those of you who have not heard about Persistent, it's a slightly smaller company, not as big as TCS or Infosys, but they play a very important role in a lot of education activities. How many of you have heard of Smart India Hackathon? So Persistent has been behind that. Okay, so they organized it. So even though being a small company, they do a lot of volunteering effort and quite vital in so many ways. And it's really some sort of a very lucky accident for us that they've come forward to do this. We're very, very happy and thankful. And maybe this is a good opportunity to recognize them ahead of time, even though the work hasn't actually started. So they'll do good to recognize them so that they feel the pressure a little bit. So please give them a big round of applause. So again, there was mention of Google and their role, and I want to emphasize the role of Google once again. I think Google is a big giant. I mean, we are not going to give them any major tribute, but just to tell you, Google out of nowhere has built this portal up. There's one engineer there who has built it from ground up. Rishabh is one of the engineers who's in that team, in the Google team. Currently, he's with NPTEL now. We are proud to say he's an NPTEL staff, so even though he's sitting in Bombay. So they gave us time of expert engineers for architecting the portal and building it up. Now that is not an easy task, and that they did. And they gave us free cloud credits to the tune of nearly 460,000 US dollars. Okay, that much money was as cloud credits was given to us for free. And to date, we have not really paid any money for the cloud usage on Google. That's tremendous. And many of their engineers work to keep the cost down. And it's completely voluntary from them. Nobody recognizes them. In fact, even I would say the ministry should recognize them in a strong way, but they haven't done that yet. So nobody recognizes them. But in spite of that, they've done this. And Sheb is one of the engineers who's played a key role in building up the portal. So let's at least give them a loud applause. So that will integrate. So once I think the Swayam portal and the NPTEL portal integrates, we will have one common portal, national MOOCs portal, that on which all of the courses will run. And that will smoothen things out quite a bit for everybody. I'm hoping that will happen. It's one of the new initiatives that NPTEL is driving going forward. Okay. So a few more things which are important. We have been always behind this, having a steady state of courses. We have not gotten there yet. We don't have an assured. So for instance, I should be able to tell you a timetable for the next 6 semesters, for the next 3 years. Okay, so of course, the first thing I need there is some sort of a funding guarantee from the ministry that for the next 3 years you can run courses. Believe me, it's not coming. Okay, so but even if it doesn't come, I should be able to at least line up faculty and say, you know, here are 6 semesters of courses. But that's very important, right? So because you have to plan for at least next 3 years, you should know something should come for sure. And we are working on that. We are trying to work very hard to make sure that can happen. At least the guaranteed basic courses, we will try very hard. Okay, so we will try to get that happening for at least a 2-year window. If it's not possible for a 3-year window, we will do that. That's something that we are strongly planning going forward. The January 2019 courses, we're already thinking about. January is okay, we can do that. So we will start a shared sheet, and please get us feedback. I mean, if you want courses, this is the time to bring it up. I think always I see SPOCs reacting after we put up the announced list of courses for that particular semester. That's too late. Okay, for January, you have to tell us now. I know it's far ahead, but that is the kind of time frame we can work on. So believe me, for faculty in IITs, there is no better incentive than saying, you know, there are 10 colleges which want your course. Okay, then they have a real incentive to come forward and offer the course. And that's a significant limitation for us. So please come back to us with what courses you want in January. Okay. Okay. So there's some very good news that I can announce for faculty of engineering colleges who've been doing our courses so far out of their own interest. NPTEL has now signed a MOU with AICTE. It's signed now, and it's already in action. For the July courses, it will be in action. So amongst the 270 courses that we are offering this semester, we will identify a subset as advanced courses. And if faculty in engineering colleges take these courses and pass the courses, write the exam and pass the courses, they can get a joint NPTEL AICTE FDP certificate, and this will count towards your career progression as points. There is a way in which this is converted, I believe, it's there in the slide, next slide. Okay, later on it will come. Okay, so this is the major thing. So you don't have to necessarily go physically to some place and do an FDP and get that to count for your career. These NPTEL certificates for the advanced courses, this is not for the basic courses. We will announce what these courses are, and you have to apply separately for the certificate. It's a nominal fee. We will give you that certificate. The joint NPTEL AICTE certificate is quite important. Okay, so this is we've been trying to do this for about a year now, and finally we have managed to do it. And I think this already a lot of faculty participate in our programs, but now this is additional incentive for faculty who get our certificates. So now there is a comparison between an NPTEL online course and a traditional FDP. Okay, a traditional FDP, you have to go to some place, spend some 3 weeks there, spend some money, effort, etc., etc. And at the end of the day, it is also not clear what you have learned, because there's been no exam, there's no hard assessment, nobody is really convinced. Okay, so now, on the other hand, the online course you can do at the comfort of your own place. There's very little money that is spent, and then you have exams, you have a certificate, you know that you have done well. Okay, so this is all very, very useful to know. This is how the certificate will look. It'll have NPTEL, it'll have AICTE, it'll have the signature of, my signature is currently there. Whoever is the NPTEL coordinator and the advisor for AICTE, his signature will always be there. The consolidated score is 99%. I mean, it will of course show only what marks you got. It won't be 99%. Your photo will be there. And below that, you can see it will say, as per the AICTE notification dated this course will count towards your FDP. Okay? And this is how the conversion is going to be done. For a 4-week course, it's going to count as half an FDP of 1 week. An 8-week course is going to count as a full FDP of 1 week. And for a 12-week course, is going to count as a 1.5 FDP. Okay, so this is their conversion. This is not in our hands. This is in the hands of the board of AICTE. If you want this to change, you have to appeal to the AICTE side. Okay, so this is how they are converting, and this is what you will get. Is that okay? Hopefully that's clear. So this is some good news, hopefully, that we're sharing with faculty. Are people happy with this or not? I'm not hearing too many applauses. Thank you. The next initiative is our connection with industry, particularly for jointly offering courses with industry. Okay, so there are two companies that have come forward now, companies or organization. The first one is IBM, which is jointly, along with an IIT Kharagpur faculty, offering a course on blockchain technology. I mean, there was a few news items on this recently. The number of registrations in that course is really, enrollments in the course is already very high. And this is going to be a blockbuster sort of course. I mean, blockchain is one of the most interesting recent technologies in this area. So a lot of people are expected to enroll in this. Another interesting course, which is not as exciting as blockchain, is from Glass Academy. This is on use of glass in buildings. Okay, glass manufacturing and use of glass in buildings. It's for civil engineering students, architecture, civil engineering students. If you're interested, you can do that. We are trying to work with more companies along similar lines. In fact, we had even visited Persistent, and we were trying to convince them that they should offer a course along with us on some of these lines. So wherever we visit companies, we were visiting Neyveli Lignite Corporation a few days back, and we were trying to convince them also that they should offer a thermal plant engineering or mining engineering, some such course jointly with us. So when an industry and academia join together to offer such courses, I believe everybody benefits. So it's a nice thing to do as well. So this is one of our new initiatives. Let's see. And your feedback in this will be very important. I mean, you should get back to us on why this is good, whether you liked it or not, so that we can take it forward. Okay, so the third initiative is, you saw quite a few people have done lots of courses with us, and they've been asking us for some sort of a transcript, okay, a consolidated mark sheet, so that they can present one mark sheet instead of presenting some 20 different certificates, which are also quite heavy. Okay, so we decided to create one. It'll look like this. It'll have the picture of the person. It'll have like a table where you'll say what course they did, when they did it, what marks they got, etc., etc. So I think this is already available on your login. So if you already have a nptel.ac.in/noc login, you can go there and look at your consolidated mark sheet, which will be there. Okay, one more initiative is the Go Green initiative. I don't know, you can think of it as Go Green. So right now, the hard copy of the certificate is delivered by speed post to the address that you put down, right? So if you write an exam, that's what you get. So in case you don't want the hard copy, okay, we are going to make your fee as 1,000 rupees. Okay, so the 100 rupees, which is our cost for doing all of that, is subtracted. So if you don't want a hard copy, so this time when you register for the exam, by the way, the exam registration form is already open and people are already registering. So if you don't want a hard copy, now there is a option in the exam registration form. You can indicate, I don't want a hard copy, and then you pay only 1,000. Okay. So this is important. But remember, there's one caveat here. So in case you say you don't want hard copy, and then maybe 6 months down the line, you realize your father or your father-in-law is saying, I want to see the hard copy, right? So then you will have to pay 200 rupees. Okay, that's like 100 rupees extra. So anyway, let us see. I mean, I want to see how this succeeds, because there's conflicting emotion all the time. If people say, I want to see the hard copy, people say, no, hard copy is a waste. So let's see how many people opt for it. If a lot of people opt for this, then we will know the actual real verdict. Okay, so this is what we're doing. So the other initiative, which has been a lot of people have asked us about, is experimental courses. Okay, a lot of people ask for experiments. I mean, how do we do lab courses? What are the kind of courses that we can do? Okay, so one nice virtual lab experiment, which is actually based on physical experiment that you can remotely control. I don't know how many of you are aware of it. We visited College of Engineering Pune, Professor Sudhir Agashe there. We went to his lab. We saw his setup. It was really very nice. So he has a control engineering plant, several plants he has, and he has sensors and controllers for that. He has pulled it out into some computer, and you can remotely access those plants from wherever you are. He has a way of allotting timetables and all that. It's actually live. You can go see, check out the, if you're from this area and you're interested, please check it out. It's a very nice setup that they have. Have any of you heard of this? It's a virtual lab experiment. Some of you have heard of this. It's amazing how good news doesn't travel at all in our country, right? If you ask them about something that went wrong, or some celebrity, something happened, everybody would know about Big Boss, for instance, but nobody knows about this. It's quite sad, I think. So maybe after our adoption, this will go a little bigger. So it's really a nice facility that he has, and I'll encourage you to check it out. It's if you're interested in this area, it's very interesting. So we are doing it in a small way. We are trying to control it because the numbers can't be too high for this. We are doing a workshop now.
So as a pilot, we are doing a workshop on today's 14th, 16th, 17th at College of Engineering, Pune. We had opened a form only for the Pune colleges for now. They said they can accommodate up to 30 people. So we are asking for faculty members to actually go there in person, spend 2 days, learn about the setup and so on. Maybe we will have a repeat of these workshops over the next 2-3 months so that faculty members can get inducted to it. And our hope is that there is a course from IIT Kharagpur by one Professor Siddhartha Mukhopadhyay on industrial automation and control, which we hope to offer in January. When that course is coming online as a theory course, we want to be able to give this setup to the colleges so that they can book slots, they can remotely access, do the experiments along with the theory course, and you also can see the practical aspect of it. So that is a way in which we are planning, at least. We'll have to see how well it goes.
Yeah, so this also requires some computing support and a lot of other things if it has to scale up. So I'm not 100% sure how easily we can do it, but we will try. That's our aim. Maybe for a limited group we can do this. So this will solve that to an extent. Now another experimental effort that we are doing recently is in collaboration with ICER Pune. For some reason, Pune keeps showing up in this workshop a lot. I don't know why. So there's a faculty member in ICER Pune called Harinath. So he's interested in running an organic chemistry lab. This is an on-premise lab. You have to actually go to ICER Pune, stay there and run the lab. Okay. But how are we going to pick people who will go into this lab? This will be based on how you do in an NPTEL course. Okay. So if you do an organic chemistry NPTEL course very well, so primarily we'll first initially begin with faculty from some colleges. If you do well in an organic chemistry course, there is money for this, I believe. Swayam has already sanctioned money for this. So we will pay people to go to ISER Pune, stay there, do the experiment, and then see how it goes. And then we will have to see how to scale that up to a larger number later on. Okay, so these are two efforts we are doing for bringing in the experimental aspects to these courses. Hopefully this will give us some idea on how to scale the experiments larger, to a larger number going forward. Okay, so internships for toppers is another initiative that we have tried. Currently these are internships at the IITs, right, from the faculty who are teaching that course. So supposing a faculty member teaches a course and then there are toppers in that course, then he or she, the faculty member, can invite the students who are toppers to come to their lab and spend some time there for do an internship. Okay, so there is some money for this. So we try to raise money for this, and some payment is given to the students for that. It's not too much, I believe. Travel and accommodation we take care of. We have started in a small way. In IIT Madras, 6 students came. IIT Bombay, 1 student came. IIIT Bangalore, 1 candidate has gone. And IIT Kharagpur, 4 candidates have gone. This has started in a small way. We are trying to scale this up, and we need some feedback from you. So for instance, how critical is it that we fund these programs? Okay, so is it, are students going to be interested even if we don't give them any money or support? Okay, so that is a question that you can try to answer. That will help us how to scale it up, because I think our ability to raise money for this is not very high. We are trying, but we'll have to see how much money we can raise. But this is a program that we are trying to push as much as possible. Okay. One more initiative was having a mobile app for the online courses portal. A lot of people have asked us about a mobile app, because everybody uses, I guess, a mobile plan these days. We are not doing what is strictly a mobile app. We are doing something called a progressive web app, okay, PWA. So actually now, if you visit the online courses portal on your mobile, you will see the PWA version. It will, if you have data, you can check it on your mobile. You will see a very different version of the online courses portal. Okay, so it is something that is tuned to your mobile browser. It will look very different. You will see a lot of things are accessed much more easily like an app. And there's also an option to have a shortcut to that on your apps page also. Okay, so it's possible. There is a little video here on how to do this. So this is how the thing will look. Yeah, so you can add it to your home screen. And then if you tap on that, it will open up. It's much, much easier to use. You can log in, you can check out your profile and see the courses that you are enrolled to. You can see all the course content, all the videos through the mobile front end also. Announcements. Progress tab is there. You can search through all courses. So few things you can't do. You cannot yet join a course on the mobile front end. You'll have to join it only on the desktop view. And you cannot also submit assignments. Okay, so these two things are a little bit more tricky. We are working on it. Hopefully by the end of this semester it will come. So all apps need feedback. Okay, without feedback apps are not going to improve. Okay, I can give you guarantees, and maybe there are enough bugs and issues there on the app. It's still called beta. We have not opened it up for full release. please use the mobile front end as much as possible and please give us feedback. Okay, so this will help us improve the mobile front end significantly and help usage. A lot of people ask for mobile front end, so this will help us. Okay?
Okay.
So the next new initiative, which has a lot of promise in closing the loop on this program, is this NPTEL Industry Associate Program. Okay, I should say it's a SWIM NPTEL Industry Associate Program. So through, just like we partner with colleges for various good purposes, we also want to partner with companies. Okay, quite a few companies are already industry associates. What can these companies do? They can work with us to say even offer joint courses, offer internships for students, offer job interviews for students who come through us, whatever it is. Just close the loop on giving students access to all these things. And also they have their own internal training and all that, which for which also NPTEL material can be useful. So all of these things we are hoping to do through the industry associates.
So these are some of the early industry associates we have with us today. One is IBM India Private Limited, Infosys Limited, Indian Institute of Industry Interaction Education Research. I think that contact person is also here with us. So actually Infosys people were supposed to be with us here today, but due to some last minute engagement, they couldn't actually come. They've asked me to make an announcement on their behalf that if any student completes a programming course, which may be C, C++, Python, which we have in our portal, and also complete a database management course, and secures more than 60% in both the courses, they will be eligible for an off-campus recruitment process of Infosys. So they are going to take it. Oh, this gets claps. Okay. So this is an announcement they wanted us to make. In fact, they're looking out for immediate recruitment, it seems. So they even told me saying that if in the next 2 or 3 weeks, if we can get a pool and we can ask the students saying if they're available actually for the recruitment and set it up either in Chennai or again, she said Pune, that they have these off-campus sites, then they are ready to interview them. So we'll send out an email, and if there are students who have completed both, but 60% is going to be a qualification. More than that, it's up to them. So this is like a base qualifier to even attend the off-site campus thing that they are looking out for. And we'll put out emails, just ask students to check it, ask them to enter and fill the form so that we can give them some data on whatever is there. Also, the other thing we are trying is some companies are approaching us to recruit either for internships or jobs. They want a more detailed profile of the candidates, which we are currently not collecting because we don't require it for somebody doing an online course. But they want to know what is a 10th standard, 12th standard mark, what is a college mark, what is this, they want more details. So we are going to start a form. We are going to send it out to all the candidates and say, if you're interested to being part of our extensive database so that we can share this data with companies, come and fill the form. So that will decide on our server. And as people have consented to, you know, share this course, we will be sharing all this information with companies who want to recruit from that pool. So that mail will also go out along with the link to the form. Please again ask your students, whoever is interested, to fill it up and tell us whether they are okay with it.
Yeah, so I think that's maybe a much more exciting announcement to make than any of the other things he was doing. But one of the things we wanted to do along these lines, I mean, this is again some initial thinking on our part, students who qualify through this process, we wanted to see if we can arrange for some sort of a mock interview sort of session, say on IIT Madras campus, instead of sending them directly off to Infosys. We are not very sure how they will answer questions in an interview. They might have done well in a course. So we wanted to see if we can bring them together here in IITM, do like maybe a one-day session with the students on training them on how to talk, how to attend an interview, maybe even do a mock interview before they go off. So something like that. Maybe you're doing it already in your college, but it's sometimes we just want to be sure that they're ready for an interview also, you know, as opposed to just knowing some subject and doing that. So we might do that. There is some funding from Arisent for that. So we might do some effort like that. But again, this is still in the initial stages. There is a similar program of TCS Ignite. You don't want to talk about it? Detailed email will come to you. Okay, so the specific email will come to you. They want one programming course and one database management. And both have to be there, minimum 60%. They will have additional criteria. I'm saying this is an entry criteria. They will have additional criteria. They will do an interview. People have to do well there also. Okay. So this is a program, I think, from my point of view, this closes the loop on what we are doing here. You know, we do offer courses. And we have to create opportunities for people who do well in our courses, particularly students, and particularly students who maybe don't have access to these kind of companies directly. Maybe you're from a place where this company doesn't go to, and there is hundreds of reasons why HR in a company decides why to go to a college. Believe me, I mean, I've seen enough companies do these decisions. It's very random, and why not? Why not use a method which is proven and tested based on performance? And even if there's one student in a college who's really good, this has a way of reaching them. So I think particularly from that point of view, this is very exciting. And we will show a bias to tier 2, tier 3 towns in these kind of things, okay? So you have to bear with us for that, and that's how it will work. Okay, so the last initiative is on translation. I'll let Pratap talk about this in some more.
So already, I mean, for all our courses, we have been doing English transcripts. So that's like a very well sort of ironed out activity that we do. And we are able to, as I think Bharati was mentioning, and Desi Crew's participation, we are really turning things around very fast. So what we are trying to do is actually do translation into Indian languages. We've picked 8 languages, actually more based on, you know, volume of usage of those languages. And 40 courses of 40 hours duration. So about 1,600 hours of video content, we are trying to translate into 8 Indian languages so that we will have notes available in the local language. We'll also have subtitles available in Indian language. So that the reach really, I mean, there should be absolutely no barrier for somebody to learn. So that's really what we are trying to do. Again, MHRD has been very kind in supporting this initiative. So we have actually received approval for this process. We had actually tried a few things on our own, and then we figured out some processes which made sense, and we conveyed that, and then MHRD has been kind enough to support it. So we are just awaiting the funding, but the proposal as such is approved. This is something that where we will require a lot of assistance from the local chapters, because clearly we need people to verify these translations. And these are, you know, we are looking for people who are both technically, you know, knowledgeable in that subject area, and also are very comfortable with that language, and will help us do this. So we are going to have a form to request faculty volunteers who know the subject as well as the local language, and we will give one sample, you know, 1 hour for people to try it out, and on that basis we will take that forward.
So we are ready with the form actually. We'll put it out again this week. So the help that we require from SPOCs is, please circulate this form amongst your colleagues and ask them to fill the form to say what subject. So we'll list in our drop down some 100 courses that we intend to translate. Choose the course you wish to translate that you have a subject expertise in. Tell us which local language also you are comfortable in. Once we get that, we are also going to approach the faculty members who have taken up exams for that particular courses and send them to the form and say whether, yeah, this is for verifying the translation. The base translation will be done by us. We just need verification of the translated transcripts. So that is what we are going to send across. For instance, in translating the transcript, we don't want the technical words to be translated. For example, if you have something like face and velocity or something like that, we just want that to be there, or it has to be transliterated. So velocity in Hindi you write as velocity, whatever, that is fine, but we don't want the equivalent word to come in because we want students to learn the technical terms. So the faculty member who is verifying the translated transcript should know what should be translated, what should be kept as is, and there will be errors in translation. When people are doing it, they are not the subject experts, there are going to be errors. These errors we want to get corrected from the faculty member. So please circulate these forms among your colleagues, get them to fill it, and then we will get the process going as to do that. This 1 hour, why we did was because some of them, when we give them the entire thing, they say it takes too much time. And we want you all to do the correction in the language itself. You'll have to type out in the local language to correct it. There are various softwares available for it, which you're comfortable with, you can use, but it does take time to get used to the software. So we'll send you a 1 hour first. Tell us if you're comfortable doing it, you'd want to do it, and you'd continue, because we also have some timelines. Within a month or two, we want the entire verified thing to come back to us and not sit with people for, say, 6 months and then say, we couldn't get time to do it. So check out 1 hour, see if you're comfortable with it, then agree to the others, we'll give it to you. There is a honorarium component associated with this. There is a certificate of appreciation that will go out with it, and on the website, we'll recognize the person who actually verified the transcripts for us. This translated version will be used for subtitling. We are planning to subtitle the video so that people, when they watch the video, can read the transcript in their local language. And also, we might give them notes. So these are the two things that we are planning with the translation proposal. Okay, I'll quickly get on to operations before we start off with the discussion. So as all of you know, last time we tried that one exam mode, one date, four exams and all that. And the feedback was not too great and positive. So this time we've again gone back to the old model of let's have one set of exams in October first week and the last one in October last week. These are the dates. There are two sets of 4 week, 8 week courses that are opening. Again, here we are opening it over a staggered period because as we keep saying, all across India, universities are opening over various months. Right from June 1st week up to September 1st week, universities are opening their current semester, which means if we want to accommodate them, at least in some which way, we have to stagger our courses. So that is what we are trying to the max of our capacity. But then if we open in September, the guys who open in June will be hitting into their semester schedule. So we are trying our optimization methods. This is what we've come up with, and that's what you see on the portal. Another thing, we have announced our courses and exam dates for this particular run in the month of March. We put it out, we finalized it, and we gave the dates. There are two, three universities that have written to us who got their schedules like 2 weeks back and said our exams are overlapping with yours. But they got the schedule just 2 weeks back, and we cannot change our current exam semester schedule for now. So this is what we have, this is what we have finalized. For January 2019, we will put up our schedule by, say, even September 1st week, I'm expecting. By then, if we know, we can change. But if after we finalize, we are booking centers with TCS in 100 cities. We cannot change booking within 3 months or 4 months. So you'll have to tell us max by October. After that, it will be freezing. On this aspect, we would like to say that we are also telling MHRD to try and see if there can be a kind of notification wherein universities across the country can open within a two-week window. That will really help people take up MOOC courses. Otherwise, it's not going to be possible for us to synchronize completely with all the universities. So that's something that they have to kind of regulate and regularize. But till then, we will put up our dates 3 months at least ahead of the start of the course run, 6 months ahead of the exam run. That is our plan for now. So this is what we have. October 7th, we have an exam going on, morning afternoon shift. October 28th, we have exam going on, morning and afternoon shift. So that is the spread of the exams. As Professor Andrew said, the exam form is already open. More than 3,000 people have already registered. So those of you still waiting to see whether I'm going to do it, please go online now, register for the exams today. Okay, just to run through for the new people, since we had a lot of hands who were saying that they are first time SPOC local chapters, I would like to say what are the steps in that, what does an SPOC do? We have logins for you on local chapter, npetel.ac.in/localchapter portal, as well as online courses portal. On the online courses portal, you get access to data dynamically as people enroll to the courses. You get a total enrollment data, you get a course-wise data, you can set mentors there. So that is where you go and actually tick mentors. I'd like to just take a minute to show this. So this is the online courses portal. You have a login here. The same login that you have shared with us for being the SPOC is the login that is here. Once you log in, there is a drop down where you can see local chapter SPOC. And once you all go, you'll get a dashboard like this. You can see the course wise how many candidates are there. You get a summary of enrollments from your college. Once you click on a particular course ID, it gives you more details about each candidate, whether they are student, faculty member, and so on. It will give you the whether they are there. And for faculty alone, the box next to it under the mentor column will be available for you to say yes or no. If you're setting them as a mentor here, this is where you will be setting them as a mentor. Automatically within that course, it will show. As already said and being reiterated, there is no choice for us to attach mentees to mentors. You have to go and tell your students that there are mentors available for this course. They have to go inside their login. They'll see a drop down. They choose the mentor. Then you can see data flow. The data cannot come that attach these 50 to them. We cannot do that. This is the way it is designed. Enrollment data availability inside your login. Again, a lot of requests we get. We don't see people. They are not enrolled. They have enrolled. We can't see them and so on. Process will be that they have to, on the enrollment form, they have to say, the minute somebody chooses role as student or faculty, the first question we ask is, do you belong to an NPTEL local chapter? And yes, all our colleges are local chapters, so they have to say yes. Then they choose the state, then they get a drop down. On the drop down, you start typing the first few letters of your college, they will see all the college names that are relevant. So if it's a, say an SRM, if there are five SRM colleges, you'll see the five listed. Choose the appropriate college. And then once they do that, the SPOC can see the data inside his or her login. If the candidate says no to, I don't belong to a local chapter, if the candidate chooses some other college instead of the college they belong to, or if they don't even know this and they type out something random, we will not be showing it inside your login. So the process will be, if they say yes to local chapter, choose the college correctly, automatically the data will come inside the SPOC login for viewing. Okay, so these are the steps. New additions this time, based on request from SPOCs from the last few interactions, have been, we have added a degree field, we've added a discipline field, we've added a year of study, whether you're a first year, second year, third year student, and so on. Motivation to do the course, and there's one question there which says, would you want to write the exam? I mean, this is just like a pre-poll we are doing, because we don't even have an idea of how many are going to write, and if I'm in five courses, right, I might be taking two for just learning, but actually I'm interested in doing the exam for probably two. I want to at least know the probability of you writing an exam. So some people come back and ask us, if I say no here, that means you won't allow me to write the exam. It's not that. We are just doing an initial survey to get some numbers, counts, which city he's from, and we can gauge something for our operations and logistics. That's all. So they can go back, and like Professor Andrew wanted me to confirm, there is an edit profile button for every user. So anytime you can go there and you can change all this data at that particular point. So you can change affiliations. If you're not seeing candidate data inside your thing, go back to the student, tell them change these affiliations. Immediately you'll see the data. So you don't even have to come back to the NPTEL office. You can just tell the students to do that. Okay, one debatable point. I would like to open it after this once we say this. There was a lot of back and forth with many SPOCs on what data we are showing inside their logins for exam registration, who gets access to scores, where do the certificates go. So this is what we have come down to finally this time. On the exam form, there is an extra question that we are asking, are you taking this exam for credit transfer? If the student says yes, then automatically there is no option for him to say, don't share my data with the college. Everything automatically becomes a yes for us. We will share hall ticket, we will share exam registration info, we will share marks, we will share e-certificates with the SPOC. So credit transfer means it's an auto yes. If they say, I am not taking it for credit transfer, in that case, he gets an option. We ask him a follow-up question. Do you want to share scores with your college? We are giving him the choice, him in the sense of him or her the choice, and there they can say yes or no. If they say yes, again, we share all the data. But if they say no, we are not going to share the data. We are not going to show them inside your login as even registered. We are not going to show them their marks, their this one or whatever. We are going to keep it this way for the sake of individual privacy here. This is the terms. In fact, one question we are asking SPOCs inside your login is your college taking exams for credit transfer? Have you approved? If you all have said yes, and the student says, I'm not taking it for credit transfer, we are giving him an alert. Are you sure your SPOC has told us that you're taking it for credit transfer? Beyond that also, he says, no, yes, we can't do anything. And suppose he says that and he says, I don't want to share. We still say, are you sure you don't want to share? Because then your college will not get the rating. Go discuss with your SPOC. We have said to that extent, we are giving pop-up messages. But beyond that, if they still stick to no, we are going to respect that. We are not going to show the data. For people who have this one, that there is an option, this yes, no can be toggled, okay? So whenever I fill the form, you can keep toggling it. The minute they say yes, suppose previously I said no, the minute he says yes, the data will be dynamically available inside the SPOC login, which means at any point of time, you can go back to your students and you want them all to share, go and, I don't know, internally, you can even mandate and say, all of you have to share. They can do it from their side. They can make everything into a yes, you will see data. But the last day of releasing marks, after that 2 days time we will give, after that we will freeze this option. And whatever data is inside your SPOC login on that particular day will be taken for ratings. Any questions on this? Any doubts, any debates? If the candidate says no for credit transfer and no, no. So if they say don't share details with my college, he will not be eligible for the fee waiver.
There is a fundamental right to privacy. Okay, so this is Supreme Court mandated. A fundamental right, you know how serious it is if somebody violates, you go to jail, right? So it's very important. We don't want to go to jail. So we cannot violate that, okay? So we give a lot of warnings to the student and tell them that if you're expecting support from your college, if you're expecting what all these things, then you should say yes. But on top of that, after reading all of that, the student says no, then they really don't want to share. And this can be for various reasons. And believe me, this option is available for every student. It's not for just your college student alone. It's available for every student. And Even from your side, I think you should support this because you might want to do a course without your college knowing. Right? Why not? It's not wrong, I think. That's the logic. Yes. The enrollment you will see, sir.
No,
the moment they have enrolled and said local chapter, they'll see. The exam registration.
Exam registration also.
Okay. So let me put it this way. So I don't want to make a decision or something. Your input is good. I can take it to our committee. We will have a committee meeting sometime in the first week of August. These are slightly critical sort of legal decisions. It's very hard for me to overrule what many people say. See, one thing that will never happen is if the person explicitly says, don't share my information. We are violating something very fundamental if we actually share it. Okay, so that we can never do. But so maybe things like numbers are possible. We can say there are so many students from your college who have registered, but they don't want to share information about the exam. So how many? Maybe we could share so that doesn't reveal anything. And do we include it in the LC rating is something we have to think about. Maybe we'll debate it once again. We take that as an input. Yeah, I understand. We'll debate this again, but this is the thing we're going to follow for July. We can't change it now. For January, we will debate it and see what we can do. Yes. Yes, yes. Some people explicitly say, and the next day if they go to court, I mean, like I said, this is way too sensitive. So we have to be very careful. So we cannot reveal the person's identity. We can put number. So that's what I said. That could be possible, which can potentially reveal. So yeah, so I, one person, yeah. So we have to be very careful. So because when they enroll, they put so much. And if there's only one guy who's coming up, you can go and figure out who that person is. So that's why I said it's complicated. Privacy is really, really complicated. And you know, you might say you don't have to do it, but as an institute, premier institute in the country, it falls on our head to implement it carefully. So it's very hard for us to violate that, sorry. Yes. 2 days after the marks are released, this option can be toggled. We'll debate this, I mean, our director is also going to come. So we'll debate this a little bit. We'll see how it goes. Sir, I know it's all with you. I know there's a lot of things to debate here. We have to think about it carefully. So let me, yeah. So see, this happens, it's complicated for me to answer this question. So when you offer an online service, right, there are rules on so many rules that you have to follow. Definitely privacy is an important rule today.
Privacy means because entire data is with us.
With you, his interaction in your college is with you. What he does on the online portal. So think of us as, okay, we are offering an academic service. Think of us like Facebook or something, right? So that's also an online service, right? What that student is doing with Facebook, you won't have, right? And it's private to him.
No.
So that's where the issue comes.
No. So after announcing the result, after the last result is out, still we give 2 more days for the person to change their mind. And they can keep on changing from now, till that time, till that last 2 days after the result.
2 days after the marks are released, they can change.
So if you just publicize to your students saying that, you know, this is useful for you and for us, if you have the data in our database, and you're able to convince them, there is no reason. So unless they have some very peculiar reason. So I think the issue with the issue with privacy is not based on complete rationalization of why they want the privacy. So they cannot. I mean, we have to accept that everybody will not be able to convince us as to why they have a good reason for their not giving that information. So we may not even agree with the reason why they're not giving the information, but they have the right not to give the information. That's the position we have to...
So, sir, I think one thing is this number is not very large. I want to convince you that this will be like one or two in your college and probably a student who will not get a gold medal or something. I'm convinced that that's true. So let's not worry too much about it. It is just that one-off case where they write an email saying, I'm going to go to courts because you revealed my information. It just becomes too ugly at that point. So
no,
that's the reason. That's
sir, what about the certificate? The certificate will come to the college, right? Even if they offer
no? No, it won't come to the college. It'll go to their address, the address that they get.
So those candidates, those are receiving certificates,
yes.
The residential address means they have opted for no?
Yes, yes.
If the person is used our college name, for example,
yes.
Our college name,
yes.
So we may know that particular details.
Yes.
That is very important. If that person is used our college name, they're putting a no means, anyhow, we may know they're using our college, but why we are hiding the details?
You have to ask your students, sir. So, see, there are two things here. One is, at the time of enrollment, they say, I belong to this local chapter. So they are happy with that. So there's no problem there. But they don't want to reveal anything about the exam. I think it's difficult to say. So you have to separate the two processes. One is enrollment and doing the online course. The other is writing the exam. Okay, these two are two separate processes. So in both processes, they have to choose whether they want to reveal information about what they are doing to the SPOC. These are two processes, and both processes they have to choose, and you have to educate them about that choice. We are also happy to educate them about that choice, but they have to choose. Unfortunately, they have to choose. It's very hard for me to take that right away from them.
That's as all. You told, the number is very less.
Yes, it's very less.
You
it's
put a note saying that if you a separate mail, please send for that thing. Otherwise, no, if you're clicking, yeah, it will be easy. If you ask you to write a mail, if those who are so particular about that, they will write a mail for you.
So our thing is, yeah, tracking, see, once, see, if you see our numbers, we have, you know, now already nearly 1,100,000 people are taking.
The registrations happen at the last minute.
So it becomes complicated if you have this flood of emails amongst a whole bunch of other email, where suddenly randomly and with all, you know, everybody wording it in a different way, in the fifth line of his email, he'll say, after all this, I don't want it. And then we have to search through all that to do it. So it works better for us, but we will put in enough pop-ups so that they understand what it is that they're doing. And they have an opportunity to correct it all the way to the end. So these are the two things. But please understand, when they say no, see, bottom line is, as a private citizen, they can anyway take. So in a way, they are not, so that is always there. As a private citizen, they can take anything they wish on our site. So they are additionally students of your college kind of thing. So this, it's an added on thing. And they're going to lose something by not declaring that they are part of your local chapter. So they are, it is not like you know, they're going scot-free for it. So they're going to lose something in the sense they're not going to have access to the fee waiver that we're giving. They won't even qualify for it. So they are going to lose something in the process. They are not going to get credit transfer because they have not shown that thing. So they're at least having two significant monetary loss as well as credit loss, both of which they, and they, if after that they say, no, we don't want to share this, we don't want to do it.
Yeah,
internship also. So many facilities are going to be denied to them because they are not.
It's very small numbers. Let's not bother about this. But we are facing an issue, but this is what we are doing. I know this causes some heat when the ratings are released. People fight with us over that. But we will fight and keep going, please. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, so for putting in mentors, the faculty member who is nominated to be a mentor has to enroll to the course. They should have chosen the role as faculty. They should choose the correct local chapter, and that's when that profile will be seen inside the SPOC login. And unless that is seen, the SPOC cannot nominate that faculty member as a mentor. So we get many mails saying that, you know, I want to put him as mentor, he's not there, she's not there, something like that. The base thing is this: either they have said they are not a faculty member, or they have not affiliated themselves to the correct college. If these two happen, automatically inside your login, you will see it. You can put the tick mark and say that they are mentors for a particular college. So first step, if you don't see them, go back to the faculty member, ask them to check their profile. If required, edit it, and then put them in as mentors. For the new SPOCs who haven't or who are going through the first run with us, our suggestions would be enroll to an NPTEL online course. Then you can know the portal, where things, different things are on the portal, how the course runs, how we send out announcements, what happens on it. And if possible, do write the exam too, so that you understand the exam process also. How the form looks like, how do you go write the exam, how the results are released, so that it'll be easier for you to handle queries from candidates from within your college about any part of the process. Next step for LCs, publicize the courses inside your colleges. We have already sent out brochures and posters to about 1,800 of our LCs. That is done. Hope all of you have, you know, put up the posters in places of prominence in your campuses and colleges. So do that. Do awareness workshops over tea and other times also. We got a lot of requests saying, can you come to my college and speak to my students? With the current bandwidth we have, with the number of people that we have available for this activity, currently, we are in no position to support awareness programs within a college for the students and faculty of that particular college. What we can do is, if 50-60 colleges participants can come at a particular place and you want to organize that workshop, we'd be happy to come there and talk about NPTEL. In fact, in the next one and a half months, I think give you a schedule of what we are doing. We've finished one in Gandhinagar. We are we finished one in Coimbatore, Gandhinagar. Next, we are going to Dharwad, we are going to Goa, we are going to Nagaland, we are going to Calcutta, we are going to Bombay for the awareness workshop. Then we are in Trichy. We got a request from Hyderabad, which we might do. So this is the kind of travel. Everything is at least 2 days, 3 days for us. The semester starts here too in IIT. So it's a little difficult once classes start here for us. So every month we try to do 2 or 3 awareness workshops from our side. But beyond that, we cannot do it for within a college. So what we say is our presentations are available online. All the PPTs that we present are there online under resources on our website. Take that down. Anyway, you all know all the information that we present to you. You all can conduct awareness workshops within your college for the students and for the thing. In fact, if you all see on the NOCSPC group, many of them send us photos and video of what they did within their college for such awareness campaigns. So that is there. And yes, as Andrew was saying, please request, start putting in your request for Jan 2019 courses you would want to see offered online. We can start work on it. Okay, issues we are aware of, we are trying to correct. Exam centers are far away from the city. This we have been addressing over the last 5 runs, I think. Same things. We give to TCS data 1 month ahead. They book so many. So in fact, that's why 6 months ahead, we have started booking centers. So for instance, Coimbatore, last time we had 4,000 people take up exams. We've already blocked 5 centers. Unfortunately, the centers that TCS has is far away. So, but we have blocked whatever is best. In Trichy, we have blocked Chennai, we have blocked Bombay, Delhi, about at least 80 cities, we have already blocked our centers with some estimate capacities. But beyond that, if we get new requests and last minute, we are able to give them numbers wherever they have possibility. Like Ram was saying, 360 days they run exams, you know, through the year they are also doing, which means people are booking ahead with them too. So we may not get, you know, the best of centers in terms of location for us to be accessible. So that may not be possible. But normally all the TCS centers that are there, the facilities are pretty good. And feedback from the SPCs, whenever we get saying there is some problem with the center, either through facilities, infrastructure, whatever, we do go back to them, we send them consolidated feedback, our own IRs give us feedback, and we tell them this is not good, don't give us the center this time. So that is definitely something we are giving as feedback to them. We work on it. Delay in dispatch of hard copies of certificates. Last time we had a major issue. It took us almost 2 months to do it. This time, I think April 28, 29th, we finished exams. May 10th, our results went out to all the faculty members for signing off on scores. May 28th, we had released scores for 226 courses. So that was thanks to our coding team who had done a lot of automation on signing off of scores. That was the new thing that we got done this time. So they had done that, and within 18 days, we completed 226 scores release. And I think another 20 days from then, we had finished printing and dispatch of certificates. At least out of the 62,000 or so, we had done 60,000. There were about 2,000 pending of some missing, some this one or whatever. That is still being handled. Some stray certificates that didn't reach them. So that is the thing. Delay in disbursing fee waiver. Yes, we have had this issue this time. One was we did not get the funds from iRecent. We only had a block of it. We were waiting to see whether we'd get the second block so that all of them, we could push it at one go. In fact, we have already started the process. So there is about 12,000 students. We have already, we are sending out the fee waivers. In another week to 10 days, I think they should all be starting to see the waivers come in. We follow the same policy, though we tried to say that we'll go through the college for the fee waivers, but last minute we said, okay, let's push it for those who paid online through the online mode, and for those who paid through college, we'll do it through the college. So if it's not too hard, we'll probably do that. The only challenge we face there is when people come back and say, I didn't get the money, and they want the UTR number or the transaction number. The bank does thousands of transactions every day for IIT through which we go. So when we ask them for, say, 15,000 people give us UTR numbers, it's a challenge for them also. So that's a problem that we are facing. But we have done the disbursal. Next time, I think we should bring this down also to within 2 weeks of results. We'll try for that. We'll get it done next time. Fee waivers for this coming semester, we do have money. iRecent has already approved for this year's budget. So we will open on the portal application for fee waivers. And I will come to that now itself probably. So the criteria for the fee waiver would be, we are keeping up the same criteria as before. No fee waiver for faculty members currently. No fee waiver to tier 1 city candidates unless we can get a very strong justification of why they require it. Yes, we do know there are deserving candidates in tier 1 cities also, but we need a kind of proof, or you all have to really certify that you require it. Tier 2, tier 3 cities and so on. SPOC has to just mention the criteria used to identify the candidates. And if the company requires proof, we will come back to you at that point of time. We will require. So you don't have to submit it to us actively, but you need to know on what basis you have qualified them. On what, you know, what was the category criteria that you use? That we definitely need to see. Waiver will be given for one exam currently. That's all we have funds for. From the LC side that we wanted to point out, timelines this time, there were not too many extensions asked for. I guess all the SPOCs have gotten the hang of how things work, how the processes go and so on. So that went very smoothly for us. Request for exam center in city. numbers not matching. This was there for about at least 20 cities last time. So SPOCs did put in requests and we did arrange for centers, but finally when the exam registration numbers came in, it did not match. We had to cancel it, reallocate them and go ahead. So when y'all give us numbers, just try to see whether y'all can give a basis for it and you really think that so many will write, because we also take a lot of effort in arranging for the same. Bulk payment, yeah, some colleges, you all give a list of so many, we'll pay through bulk. So you all say, yes, 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 we expect, say, 1,69,000 to come, 1,67,000 will come. And we don't know who the two candidates who you've not paid for are. Then we have to contact, call. We are not able to reach SPOCs when you're in class. Mails are getting missed. So a kind of delay is happening. So when you all are making payments in bulk, that 3-4 days, kindly be in touch with us to see that your accounts are settled. Otherwise, we have an issue in kind of, you know, collating the data and seeing whether it actually matches for us. And again, please instruct your students to check emails and SMSs from us. We are doing so many notifications to them about forms not being filled correctly, if the photos are not good, if the signatures are not good, for them to check hall tickets. We are sending so many emails and SMSs, but I don't know, they don't seem to check it. In fact, to date, if y'all can believe it, we have 30 candidates whose SCST certificates we had declared as invalid have not even come back to us with the correct certificates. We have not given them the scores or the e-certificates. I don't know what they're doing. They've written the exam, but they have not yet come back to us. So this is the status. We have been sending them repeated reminders on that. So ask them to check for emails. So this is what we said. So many SPOCs had written that some candidates, they can't see the scores and the e-certificates. This is because we have blocked it for them. When we get the correct, they have already availed the 50% waiver that we give them while filling up the form. But when we find the certificate, it's some random thing and not the actual certificate, in which case we have held it up for them. We did not block the hall ticket, but going forth, we may do that. For now, we are still sending them the hall ticket. We are allowing them to write the exam. And post-exam, we are holding up on scores and thing. But actually, this should be done pre-exam. We have not yet kind of locked down on it, but we may. So if they are availing that, please ask them to kind of give the proper documents. Interesting part, this is the kind of photos we get for our certificates. Please tell your students, these are certificates that go out with the IIT brand. This is the kind, we got a selfie guy on a phone, green color photo certificate. There's a Sachin Tendulkar photo. I mean, you want a certificate with Sachin's photo on it? I don't know. That's what we got. There's a guy with a cartoon there and which says, nice one. That's the photo he gives for the certificate that is getting uploaded. Then we have this multi-photo thing. I mean, if we people don't check, you wouldn't believe 87,000 people when they submit forms. Our office does a manual check of 87,000 photos. We have people for the day in and day out, we are sitting and just taking photo, tagging them incorrectly. At the end of the day, we are pushing out emails and people don't respond. Beyond the point, we are not going to do this. Sachin's photo comes, you'll get a certificate with Sachin's photo. 3 photos come, we are going to push with 3. Whatever you have submitted, it's going to go as is. As of now, we are trying to see whether we can do things, but if it's not working, and there's one more girl. There's a girl's half face in that. What are we supposed to do with such photos? I mean, we feel bad that IIT certificates are going out with these kind of photos and we are not allowing it currently. So kindly tell your students to send some professional level photos for the certificates. If they really value it, I think it should be there. I even tell students when they write, in fact, I send mails, which might seem harsh. I say, if you come to me with a certificate that has a photo on this, the first thing I will not recruit you is because you don't even have the responsibility of giving a good photo. That's the first thing for me when I see for a job recruitment. So that's something that you want to say. Signatures, again, there are illegible signatures, fingerprints. I don't know how we are supposed to verify a fingerprint on the day of the exam when we are, you know, verifying signature. This is something they upload. On the back side, there's something. Then it's with some taglines and also some clear signature that they do that we want uploaded. Supplementary exams, I just want to make a case in point here. So we had a meeting in the MHRD wherein they were, again, we were discussing about how to do re-exams and supplementary exams for people who do not clear the courses in case of credit transfer. Courses being taken for credit transfer. So we are still working out on the methodology. We have not yet finalized on it. So for the current semester, this is what we are proposing, at least for the NPTEL exam. So if a candidate has not passed or is absent for an exam, which is very important, one is, yes, when the course is reoffered, they can take it. That is one possibility. We are reoffering most of our courses. Second is that we are saying that if the university can take charge of the re-exams, assignments and solutions are public. So you have at least, say, for an 8-week course or 12-week course, there are at least about 100 to 150 questions that have been given by the faculty member with the solution. Based on that, if a local faculty member can set up a question paper, internally run the exam for the student, clear them, and give them whatever they require, that would be really great. For this semester, at least, we are proposing this. For the next semester, if we have a policy on re-exams, we'll update you on that. So this is there currently. We have a guidelines and timelines page that's been newly introduced. So I don't know how many of you have written GATE or JEE exams. They have a page wherein all the timelines and data comes in. Any changes we make it there. Because people say, I didn't get your mail, it went to spam, I didn't see this, I didn't receive that. So no more saying, I do not get information. Information is going to be on our web page. As we keep changing timelines, we will update it there. It is the job of the candidate to go there and see if anything has changed. We will send emails, we will send communication, but if you all don't receive it, miss it, or it, for some reason you don't go through it, it's always here. So don't come back and say we don't have information. So that is there. The link is given here. We'll share it with you shortly. Yeah, I think we are done with the presentation part of it. We can now open it completely for a discussion. Maybe 15 minutes will take. 1:30, we will start with the plaque distribution for the next set of colleges.
See, you told that a particular student is absent or not passed, right? So you can consider that absentees, no? So you can consider to the next academic year at least, or next semester.
See, normally we say they have to re-enroll to a course and go through the course again to write the exam, because the faculty offering that course itself may be from some other institute. In IIT, the institutes are very different. The syllabus for the courses are also different. Though broadly same, the way the course is treated may be very different from different IITs too. So if I have a digital communications course the student has done from, say, IIT Madras this time, he's been absent for an exam. The same course comes from IIT Bombay next time, he may not be able to attempt it. It's a little difficult. So currently, we are not keeping memory in the system for assignments. We are saying re-enroll, redo the assignments, and you can appear for the exam. Nothing
no,
stops.
What they paid already, the 1,100.
We are paying to TCS. The minute exam registration happens and we are generating a hall ticket for you, we are already paying TCS. We are paying GST. We are paying our institute. We are doing all that. The only thing that we hold on is that 100 rupees for the certificate. That's all.
Okay.
An absent candidate, that's all remains.
No, my suggestion is at least you can... send half, 50% of the...
We are already paying, ma'am, 1,000 rupees we are spending already the minute a student registers. That's what I'm saying. The only part we have with us is the 100 rupees for the certificate copy. So but once you all register, we are assuming they come to the exam, right? So we have to pay TCS, otherwise they won't have a system there that day.
No, what they wrote, the assignment and all, at least we can consider...
So currently, we are not keeping it. Going forward, if the systems get integrated, we may look into it, but we are not too sure about that.
Okay, thank you.
One thing I want to discuss... In the SPOC login, if a student is selected a mentor, the mentor name should be appear at the along with the student details. Why? Because we are unable to track the students who are not selected the mentors. If the mentor name also available with the student detail, we can discuss with the mentor about his performance, everything. Yeah.
No, we wanted left to side. Show something here.
Down. Yes.
Okay, this is for colleges who think about how to publicize NPTEL inside, how to give information. If your college has, say, 15,000 students, how do you reach out to them? This college has a whole dedicated sub-website for NPTEL, wherein they have, similar to us, home, local chapter, notifications, who are the coordinators of departments, events, what are the timelines, datelines, what happened. They keep updating everything on their college portal itself. So this is the way that they are reaching out to in a big way to their own students, faculty, and so on. So we just wanted to showcase that this would be easy if y'all want to also, give out communication within your college. This is something that y'all can think of. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I want to tell about one faculty. Is SP Kishore, mathematical faculty. Till now, he registered for 5 courses. In all the 5 courses, he's the topper. And subject, he's got 100 out of 100. 5 subjects only written, 5 subjects topper.
Okay.
Right. Sir, ma'am, about mentor. The mentor name should be appear with the student details. Then only we can track the student, how he is performing, and who is the mentor for the particular student.
Inside nptel.ac.in/localchapter.
No. Online courses portal.
Okay. Our team is here. We will tell them. Sure. Yeah. We can work on. You can make note. No?
And one more thing about exam center.
Yeah.
In Hyderabad, in the last semester, the exam center is very too far from the city. Why? Because many TCS science centers are available in the within the city, but you are given the center which is very far. So please arrange the centers in the around the city, within the city. Ma'am, you told that students are uploading the photos, different types of photos. If the student is paid directly, we are unable to check the photos and signature. If you give the option to the SPOC, if you paid directly also, okay, so SPOC has to check the photo and signature, he has to give the approval.
I think now the photo is seen inside the SPOC.
You can see, but right? There is nothing is in our SPOC hand. Directly it is going.
I don't know if you want to get loaded with more work on your side. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, or loaded, but you are telling that the students are uploading the different types of
but
photos.
But I think 18 plus, they should take care of uploading a nice photo. They have to, but 3 years down, they are going to get into a
sometimes
job.
Sometimes faculty so also uploading selfies and different things, ma'am. I observed many times. So that's what.
Enrollment, it's like 10 lakhs. We don't want to load that portal.
If they say no, not an issue. If they say yes, that has to go through the SPOC. No means okay. No. That's a privacy.
No, we not look into that. But whether your will say even for when payment comes through SPOC, we have to send so many reminders out to say please say yes, whether you'll pay, because if the last date goes and supposing an SPOC says no, we have to tell the student that he has not made the payment and you have to pay to register. Right? That's more critical for us.
Okay,
for
okay.
That itself, we have to call up at least 100 people and say you still haven't done it.
Yes, sir.
So more so on photos and all, I think we may not want to get.
Okay,
it.
Thank
see,
you.
On a lighter note, I think this day and age, they should know how to take a selfie.
Yes, sir.
When our academic council is sitting, when we are observing some of the courses, some courses of NPTEL are just superficial and some courses are going completely in depth. Even if we take the IIT syllabus and the course names are same, but the syllabus is not common, with which what is happening, we are unable to justify either in the Board of Studies meetings or in academic council meetings to say that these are the same things. So let us take some IIT syllabus or NIT syllabus, and if that some 80% matching is if it is available, then credit transfer will be easy for every institution. Kindly have a look into it. Few examples are engineering mechanics is a basic subject. It has gone to heavy depth in the NPTEL, whereas all the JNTU Kakinada, JNTU Hyderabad, and JNTU Anantapur, NIT Warangal, if I take these courses, their syllabus is not too up to that depth. Similarly, mechanics of solids, that is also in the similar lines. And other side, design of machine members, if I take, the depth covered in the NIT and IITs and these university syllabus is full depth, and whereas the course covered by NPTEL is only superficial.
Okay.
So both the sides, the things are seen. So some corrective action is required, what I feel.
Sure, I think so. See, course content specific feedback is very welcome. This kind of feedback, please write an email to us saying that this is the, so for instance, since you have looked at the syllabus and all closely, if you send an email saying this is the syllabus and this is what's being covered, maybe more should be covered, that feedback we can easily take to faculty and that problem can be very easily fixed. Don't think that cannot be fixed, but it needs to come from you. I think when it comes from you, it's very, very easy to do. Please send such specific feedback. It's very welcome.
WhatsApp group is a bigger nightmare, sir. So we'll think about it. Maybe a good solution is to have an app, right? An app in which you can participate, which we build on our own. So yeah, so we can control that. Basically, you're saying a better app for people to interact with. Sure, you can think about it.
Sir, one suggestion from my side is last time hired as a TCSI and center coordinator. So during that time, NPTEL exam, I found that after 1.5 hours, all the students are gone out. So why don't you make it right all 2 hours or 3 hours?
Yes, so that's a site that has worried me also. A lot of people are leaving at 90 minutes as soon as the exam is over. So we are tracking that statistic also. In case you want to tell your students, you can tell them that. We have the statistic of when people leave the exam hall, and we are going to look at that very closely with how they are doing, what marks they are getting, etc. And we will look at the data very, very closely and we'll arrive at something.
Thank you.
We are looking at it.
Hyderabad, we have three centers, TCS centers, three are there. Three times from our college went there, and within 2 hours, they are completely fatigue.
Yeah.
Because AC is not there, sweating. April exam, they could not write because they're getting headache. So yeah. they left the exam hall.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I know that feedback you have to give us. You have to write back to the centers, but centers where AC, yeah, it's not compulsory, but we will try to push a little harder on that. Please give us that feedback. Yes, there can be multiple reasons why people leave the center.
So with respect to exam centers, since we visit a lot of exam centers for various exams from IIT side, there is a lot of variability in what infrastructure is available there. And so an exam partner like TCS has some basic minimum things that they're looking for. So, and that is primarily with respect to conduct of exam. So, I mean, AC, I know in places where it is kind of hot, definitely at a personal level, we do want it. But from a conduct of exam thing, it clearly is a second level of importance is given to AC. More important is that there should be electricity, there should be LAN connection, whatever it is that they require for running the exam. So I think they give, and also you should also understand numbers have gone up. So when we look at 100,000 students and we want to provide enough centers for 100,000 students to take their exam, then eventually you will have centers where, you know, these kinds of comforts may not be there, but maybe other things are being met. And therefore we have to take that center. And also you have to look at logistically, it is a center that is closer to more candidates. So that also becomes an issue. So taking all that into consideration, we end up with centers which may not be very comfortable, but do the job. So that's the reason.
Please shed some light on what your alliance with Indan Shala means. The reason why I'm asking this is, the moment I gave permission in my SPOC login, I got a mail from them, and they asked me to submit the entire college database. So I uploaded that, and immediately after, our students started receiving mails to enroll in Indan Shala courses, and they're giving discounts. To enroll in Indan Shala course. And all these students are approaching us whether to enroll for Indan Shala course or to NPTEL course. So I just want to know what
is. So Indan Shala is just one of the biggest companies today providing, at least facilitating internship opportunities for students. So we had an MOU saying that whatever colleges affiliated to NPTEL can also avail their services. Whether you want to do it, you don't want to do it, you want to pull out of it, that is left to each local chapter's choice. So the only thing we thought is if there are colleges that do not have access to companies who wish to offer opportunities, this might be a good platform where your students can go online and probably, you know, put in a form and try to get internship possibilities. So beyond that, we have nothing to do with them. There's no preference as such, but we just thought it's a good partnership to tell colleges that this is available, that's all. Yeah, so we are not doing anything. That's why we say, we just sent a request to ILC saying that there's an opportunity here for you. Beyond this, you can take it forward. Whatever you want to share, you don't want to share, that's all up to the ILC. We are not there beyond that. We just have a partnership with them for that. In fact, we don't even get data from them. We ask them how many NPTEL candidates actually have gotten internship because of you, and even that data they don't share with us. They say privacy. So we said, okay.
One more thing I would like to suggest is Indan Shala has this student ambassador program.
Right.
So why can't NPTEL have a similar program? Because
we did start off one, but it didn't kind of pick up. So we'll have to revisit that probably at some point of time.
Because in my opinion, in my college, the student ambassador program is succeeding in a big way. So
okay. We'll probably take it forward.
Madam, we started the NPTEL local chapter in the year 2014, I think. So at the time only
Which college, sir?
I am Dr. Sindhil Kumar from Sona College, Salem.
Yes, sir.
So at the time only the 200 colleges. So the first 10 positions are rated as AAA. Now the total number of NPTEL local chapters are nearly 1,800. So my suggestion is you can increase the ratings up to 20 or 25. The first 25 position may be rated as
we are going to revamp the entire system. So this is the same thing we were thinking, that we'll make it a variable thing. So how many hours, just like in IITs, they grade wherever there's a big break in the points, that is where they cut the S grade, A grade, B grade. We thought instead of top 10, top 40, we will also change the thing. The other thing that we were calculating and looking at for this semester is just adding up the raw scores of all candidates, 60 plus and above up to 100. Because a student who gets 60 and who gets 89 today in elite category gets only 2 points in our system. While a 60 mark is very different from an 89. So we were working out a lot of things, at least 5-6 methods we brought about. We said, okay, what do we do with these things? We are reworking it. We'll put out some information in the next 2 weeks on that. So
yes,
it is getting revamped. Yes.
Same thing in the elite category also. The 60 to 89 is a very large band. 89 is very good mark, but 60 is average. But we are giving in the same category, introduce one more slab in between 60 to 75 and 75 to 89.
Okay, sir, we look into it. Thank you.
Madam, one small suggestion.
Yes, sir.
When we are doing some of the courses like knowledge management, innovation, pedagogy and all, some links were given to us. Those links are helpful in preparing the course structure and sometimes in pedagogy, suppose. They stated very clearly that this link will work for you in the future also. But once our course is completed, that link is not working.
Okay.
So please
send us an email, we'll check on that, sir. Depends on where they have taken the link from or what is the validity of the link.
Yes.
We'll have to check on that.
That is also, that link is made from IIT Madras itself, it seems.
No, that's what it could be, a local reference link that they have moved documents from.
Yeah.
If it's an online thing, it should work. That's why I want to know, saying you send me the exact thing, we'll just see where it is.
Right.
If it's on the drive or something that they've shared, we would have closed the drive probably. Okay. So we'll see that.
Thank you, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, regarding assignments, I have a on complaint. While submitting the assignment, some questions were be mistaken, ma'am. Options,
right,
or questions.
Correct.
Last time, especially in programming subjects.
Right.
While submitting the answers, we have discussed also. So some questions were mistaken, options were mistaken. They said we'll consider at last, but at last they didn't update the.
This for the maths. Exam or the assignments?
Assignments, ma'am.
Which course specifically?
Problem solving through programming in C.
Okay. Yes, so our sir is here from Kharagpur, Das sir. We'll look into that definitely. But with regard to assignments, yes, we have been seeing some errors there wherein there is wrong configuration of answers or question itself is incorrect. When we are doing so many things across the board, we do keep telling the faculty for quality check. So there are corrections that we are doing wherein if the incorrect option is set, we can correct the option and we regrade the whole thing. We send out an announcement. If the question itself is wrong, we do ignore that question, recalculate, send out an announcement. So that's done, and we will take this into account. We will check on what has happened, but ideally within the week we do sort out all issues that come out. I don't think we have kept it open, but we can talk over lunch maybe on what specifically the issue was. For programming courses, I would like to say that please ask the students to go through the type of code that has to be written to get the presentation out properly to be evaluated. For instance, if you have an ascending order, the way it works is the code output should be, if I'm giving an input of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and okay, you want descending order, it has to be 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Many times a student will write printf, the order is and all. That is not there in our backend. We will have only 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, which has to be compared. So all those will be marked wrong. So ask them to just check the code properly so that it works for all cases. That was one thing we saw in the C programming course last time, big time.
Especially we got for theoretical questions, ma'am.
Oh, theoretical questions.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Sure, we'll look into that.
Excuse me, ma'am.
One thing we'd like to give us feedback here, another reading that we are doing of all the scores is, we were checking the failures in many courses when the results came out finally. In some courses, we had like bulk failure. So we're seeing what is happening here. And in a few cases, at least, we saw most of the students were from a local chapter. Assignment scores are all 100 on 100. Exam score is about 5 or 10, which means, yes, they have been helped or they have been I don't know what has happened there, that they've all gotten 24 and 25 in the assignment, but the exam score is not reflecting the learning that they have acquired during the course. At that point, we said, okay, we don't have to look into it more because overall, otherwise, the performance is good. So one thing, when colleges are helping students to learn, please do not give them the correct answers and say, put these answers, you'll get your marks. That's not what we want mentors or somebody else to do. Teach them how to do it, let them explore for some time and then learn. Otherwise, they can't do it. Yeah.
Excuse me, we are recently enrolled a local chapter. We don't have any certificates from your side that we are
there members. Is an acknowledgement letter on the website inside
the login. Yeah, you just provided only acknowledgement.
Because you've just become.
Yeah, right. Yeah, but management asking certificates like framed structure.
No, we don't have that. Only the letter is the acknowledgement. That's
okay,
all.
Why don't you provide it like that?
The letter is there. You can download and use it. It's on our letterhead signed by the coordinator. It's an official letter of us that we are providing.
Yeah, you are providing a letter, but why don't you provide a certificate like we take as the suggestion?
It's very
also
difficult, sir. So many logistics, it's just not workable. Already there is too many things that's going on.
Okay.
So if you all can just take it and use it, it's fine because it's an authorized letter anyways.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Madam, I am Ramesh from PhD College of Technology, Coimbatore.
Yeah.
So in our college, we received more number of requests from research scholars.
Yes,
there are more full-time research scholars as well as part-time research scholars.
Yes.
So they have requested for offering research-based courses so that they can take up those courses as for them as a coursework.
Okay, sir.
So we received
Please
more
send us
requests.
A list, sir. We'll look into it definitely for Jan 2019.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
In SPOC local chapter page, in overall results, please kindly include either the fellow is student or faculty or either roll number. You're asking while filling the form, you're asking. But in the overall results page,
so now everything is being shown, sir. Everything is now included.
In overall results page,
yeah, yeah, complete data has now come in. They have already pushed in all the data.
One more question, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Somebody is registering, they are writing exam, they are getting certificates without our knowledge, college knowledge. Mm-hmm. Through local chapters, they are registering, they are getting certificates. They are not showing their ID card, they are writing exams with the government ID proof. How we don't we know that they are writing?
That is the thing, sir. If they tag your local chapter, college in yes. that, and they say share my scores with the college, inside your login, it will come.
Yes, but they are not sharing.
The that's what we discussed. If they don't want to share, we can't do anything.
The third fellow is who is not related with college. They are writing exam. They are getting certificates without college knowledge. They are not our college student. They are not, they are third persons. Through the Google account, they are coming.
No, can you please repeat? I didn't follow. There's somebody who is not your college student.
They are writing exams. They are getting certificates.
Yeah, sure.
We should
yeah,
approve
so verification,
them.
Yeah, that is something that we have
yeah,
to look
yeah,
at. Yeah,
to close the loop, we are aware of this particular problem. So this time we are working on that also as to how to get an ID
problem
to check
come.
Whether they are from the college. Okay, last question. After this, Professor Bhaskar Ramurthy, our chairman of PIC, director of IIT of Madras is here. We'd like to start off with the distribution of plaques to the remaining colleges. We will be available after, during lunch, post-lunch, everything here for more discussions. We'll take up your questions then. The last question we'll take now. Yes.
As autonomous college of LBRCA and some JN to Tatnada, Anantapur, Hyderabad, your NPTEL exam and our SEM end exams is going to be parallelism.
We got the notification. That's what I was saying. Only 2 weeks back, we got this information from JNTU, Anantapur and Kakinada, I think. But our schedule is done 6 months ahead. So now we can't change for this semester.
After this... from January 2019.
So for January, we'll publish in September. But if you tell us by September, we can also change the schedule. But beyond October, when we start booking TCS centers, we cannot change schedules. So you all try to get the academic schedule for your universities ahead so that when we publish, you all can give us some dates.
One more issue is that, you know, the schedule of various universities is varying enough that it is impossible to actually find a date that will be clear for everybody. So more or less, only thing we can do is it's a Sunday. So expectation is somehow, you know, if the center is not too far, students can manage. That's really the best that we can do. Although we try our best not to clash, we are not able to guarantee it. That's the reality today. In fact, AICT is trying to see if they can schedule it, give some notification to encourage colleges to keep their exams roughly in the same kind of time frame. It need not be exactly the same date, but roughly the same time frame, so that other dates become open and available for these kinds of exams. So that's something that's going on in the parallel.
Okay, we'll close this session here for now, but as I said, we'll continue later. I invite Professor Bhaskar Ramurthy on stage, Director of IIT Madras and Chairman of NPTEL PIC program, to kindly address, and then we'll probably...
Good afternoon to everybody assembled here. You have to be chairman, you have to be like this position. I don't have to worry at all, they handle everything. And they just called me to come and say a few words. Program is really growing fantastically by leaps and bounds. What we started in a cautious way, you know, this is because there's a lot of talk about MOOCs. And of course, like everything else, people are coming from abroad and telling us how MOOCs should be done. Which is okay, except that we felt some of the method, you know, the directly, simply doing it the same way will not work here. And so we started trying to feel our way forward. And I think now we have got a methodology and an approach which seems to be working. We are offering a very large number of courses. I would say comparable now to any other MOOCs program in the world. Yeah, both in terms of number of courses and number of registrants, and more in terms of the number of people writing the exam. The fraction, we are anticipating that will go up very fast now. And also, but more important, I think in all of this, we want to make sure value is delivered. You know, it's not just numbers and showing that, oh, this is happening, that's happening. We want to make sure that in this process, something that is very difficult to do, which many of us are very cautious and I would say to some extent on the side of skepticism, you know, will it work? Can you actually teach large numbers through this medium? Will it actually deliver the same value that you get from a good teacher in a face-to-face classroom? All of us have been concerned about these things. And we are seeing that it is moving in the right direction, that yes, we can figure out how to do this. And in this, I'm grateful to all the colleges, all the teachers from the colleges, the local chapter, through the local chapters, all the students who are because we are learning this whole process. We're trying to figure out this process together. It's very important in this that when we do this, that or at every stage while we figure our way forward, how to do everything, how to ensure that, we have to make sure that in the end we can very confidently say that the course is taught very well, that you can, of course, anybody can go to the video and see, but that the students are benefiting, that benefit is translating in terms of performance in the exams, in the actual knowledge that they have, and finally, in terms of the placements, jobs, higher studies, everything that they are able to pursue. So this chain we have to ensure. And in this process, you know, everybody is benefiting, the students, the colleges, the whole educational ecosystem. This is very important because otherwise, you can have a program that is simply not really meaningful. You can also have a program that appears meaningful, but not really that meaningful. And then you can have a program that is actually ticks all the boxes, something that shows how the new methods can be used properly, shows how large numbers can be done, and shows how value can be delivered. This is very important. If we proceed in these lines, I think we already had very good progress. We would have actually, in my view, done something for the first time in the world in a very significant way. Because if you look at the potential impact of this kind of approach in solving a huge problem of scaling, which we have in the country and other parts of the world also have, at very, very, affordable cost, very often, in general, in an abstract way, I'm saying, when something is done at very low cost, some other price is being paid, except you don't count for it. Typical example is in manufacturing and, industry, you pollute a lot. But we are trying to do this in such a way that actually nothing is being exploited, that everything is being taken care of, all the costs are being taken care of, whatever has to be paid for is being paid, and still it is affordable. So this is there are many potential big gains from getting this right. So I would urge all of you to stay with us in this exercise, in this learning process. Just from the few questions I was hearing now, I can see there are many concerns, but in all of these, figuring the way out, we must make sure that all these things happen. That is, we do something, we offer very good pedagogy, very good teaching, inspirational teaching. We offer very good outcomes, learning outcomes, and finally in terms of outcomes to the students, especially the youngsters, in terms of their job or slightly older people if they want to go into higher studies or simply learn for becoming more knowledgeable, that this value is delivered. And in the process, everything, our entire education system improves. So I want this partnership that is exhibited by this full hall here, and of course there are 1,700, so we don't have a hall. If everybody decides to come, we don't have a hall.
No, we are going to have but it in SAC.
Okay, they are doing it in four zones. So they are meeting everybody. I hope that this part, and of course all the IITs, all the IIS, everybody is involved, but also all the education institutions, so many colleges are involved. We are seeing contributions increasingly from the teachers across the board. And soon alumni will be starting to play a role. I am very sure about this, because if something is good, everybody retains the connection for their life. So they will come forward to contribute. So this can become a movement. People talk about movements very easily, but movements actually don't come because they are created. Movements happen. So this can become a movement. So I want to convey this to all of you, that you might be part of something which can be very good and very big. So don't let go. Thank you very much.
So now I would like to invite Shri Parmeshwaran on stage to also be there when we give away the plaques to the local chapters. I would also request Professor Godanda Raman, Director of UGC Human Resources Development Center and Head, University of Madras, Chennai, to also be there. Before we start with the college things, I would like to say that, our team has been kind of changing a lot. Every 6 months we see, maybe even when SPOCs come here, there are very few regular faces, but a lot of our team keeps getting overhauled. But we've had three people with us who have stayed with us for 5 years now, completed 5 years at NPTEL, and are one of our strongest pillars, upon whom we have actually built upon. I would like to first felicitate them and then get on to the colleges. So I'd like to call upon Kamala Ramakrishnan here, who has been with us from 2013. So this is a surprise to them. That's why I had to do all the groundwork for this. She was first initially in text transcription. Now she plays a huge part in the operations part, coordinating with TCS, the local chapters, and everything. Next, I'd like to call upon Jayanti. She has also been with us for 5 years. She was mainly handling the question paper part of it, and now she's joined the IIT Kharagpur team to also manage operations there. So she has also played a big role in stabilizing one part of NPTEL, putting processes in place. I'd like to call upon Lakshmi Priya. She's also completed 5 years with us, one who knows our online courses portal in and out, one who handles our SWIAM portal for us, all the scoring, the certifications, local chapter ratings, and so on. Okay, so now we'll start with the local chapters that have been rated AA. So next comes Techno India Salt Lake, that will be in Kharagpur, BP Poddar Institute of Management Technology, Calcutta. We call upon Sri Krishna College of Engineering and Technology. Professor Soundarajan is SPOC, but he's not there. So there is another faculty member from the college who's come to collect the plaque on his behalf. So they have 1,031 present for the exams, 440 successful, 365 elite, 5 toppers. Next, I call upon National Engineering College, Mr. Karunai Raghavan. So again, NEC has been with us from 2014, I think 4 years now. They have 736 present, 9 toppers, 4 gold. Next, I would like Satyabhama Institute of Science and Technology, RV College of Engineering, VNR Vignan Jyoti Institute, please SPOCs come forward. Satyabhama Institute, Ms. Sundareshwari. Is she not there? You have marked it. Okay. Techno India College of Technology is next. Then we have RV College of Engineering. They're not here. VNR Vignana Jyoti Institute of Engineering and Technology. Dr. Ravi Kumar. Next we have Ramaya Institute of Technology. Then I call upon JNTU Anantapur College of Engineering. Dr. Murli, please come forward. Then we have Gudla Valleru Engineering College. G. Narayanamma Institute of Technology and Science for Women, who are not here. I call upon Sagi Ramakrishnam Raju Engineering College next. Mr. N. Gopalakrishnamurthy is here to collect the plaque. Then I request PSG College of Technology, Mr. Soundarajan, Sona College of Technology, Sendil Kumar, Vardhaman College, Madhu to kind of step forward. Next, I call upon PSG College of Technology, Coimbatore. Mr. Soundarajan is the SPOC. He's not here today to collect. Next, we call upon Sona College of Technology. Dr. Sendil Kumar, kindly please come. They have 19 toppers, 7 gold, 337 present for the exams. Next, we request Vardhaman College of Engineering. Dr. Madhu to come forward. 19 toppers, 4 gold again. Okay. Then we call upon Sri Krishna College of Technology. R. Maheshwar is the SPOC. I think in his place somebody has come to collect. I request next RVRJC College and Sri Sairam Engineering College SPOCs to come forward. MVP Chandrasekhara Rao and N. Sivagami. Next is RVR and JC College of Engineering, Guntur, Andhra Pradesh, RVR JC. Dr. Chandrasekhara Rao is collecting the plaque. Then I call upon Ms. Sivagami to collect on behalf of Sri Sairam Engineering College. I request Rajalakshmi Engineering College, Panimalar Engineering College, VIT University, Vellur, SPOCs to please come forward. I request V. Prasanna Kumari, faculty of Rajalakshmi Engineering College, to please come on stage. I request Ms. Vindmati of Panimalar Engineering College to please come forward. Mr. Govinda of VIT University, Vellur. Then I request Kongu Engineering College, SSN College of Engineering, Aditya Institute of Technology, SPOCs to please step forward. Mr. Navaneetha Krishnan of Kongu Engineering College. Oh, you're coming. Okay. There's somebody instead of them to pick up the plaque. Mr. Sethuraman for SSN College. Yeah, I'm just changing it. Request Mr. Yugandhar Dasari of Aditya Institute of Technology and Management. I request SRM University Ramapuram and Maharaj Vijayaram Gajapati Raj College of Engineering SPOCs to also step forward. Mr. Madan and Mr. Kona Mahesh Madhav. This is Aditya Institute of Technology and Management. So they have 15 toppers, 5 gold, 158 present for the exam. Mr. Madhavan for SRM University, Ramapuram. Okay, instead of him, some of the faculty members collecting the plaque. Request Mr. Mahesh Yadav of Maharaj Vijayaram Gajapati Raj College of Engineering to kindly come forward. Then I request Sethu Institute of Technology, RMK Engineering College, SPOCs to please step forward. Professor Nagalakshmi and Professor Vijaya. Professor Nagalakshmi, Sethu Institute of Technology, that comes next. They have 7 toppers, 3 gold, 298 who appeared for the exam. They have also, I think, partnered with us for 4 years now, getting rated every time in the top 100. Then we have RMK Engineering College, Professor Vijaya. This is in Tiruvallur, 5 toppers and 1 gold. Then I call upon JPR Mamalan Engineering College, Sri Akhilandeshwari Women's College, Vasi Reddy Venkatadri Institute of Technology, the SPOCs of these colleges to step forward, please. Mr. Shakti Murgan of JPR Mamalan Engineering College. Professor Selva Kumar for Sri Akhilandeshwari Women's College, Mandavasi. Professor Banu Murthy of Vasi Reddy Venkatadri Institute of Technology, Guntur. 5 toppers and 206 present for the exam. Then I request Panimalar Institute of Technology, Mahendra Engineering College, SPOCs to please step forward. Professor Joshi and M. Kannan. Next is Panimalar Institute of Technology. Yeah, give it. Professor Joshi, it's there. And Professor Kannan of Mahendra Engineering College, Namakkal. BVRIT College of Engineering, Professor Vasanti. Okay, they're not here. Srinivasa Ramanujan Institute of Technology. Professor Praneel Kumar Peruru. Lendi Institute of Engineering and Technology.
What is 678? Are they here or
not?
The last one,
Kalasalingam. Okay, and Kalasalingam Academy of Research and Education. So for Lendi Institute of Engineering and Technology, we request Professor Anji Reddy to come forward, please. And G. Murga Bhupati for Kalasalingam Academy of Research and Education. Yeah, so with this, we complete the 100 local chapters for today. I request Sri Parameshwaran to kindly share his views on how... Sir, 2 words, 4 words.
Respected Professor Ramurthy, sir, Director IIT. Professor Andrew, Professor Haridas Bharti, grateful for inviting me here to be with you today. Now you have all seen that what started only as NPTEL has grown now to SWAYAM NPTEL. All the other faculties are also coming in that. In fact, it's the level of energy of all the local chapters is very nice, very good, nice to be here. And congratulations to all the local chapters who have done extremely well. In fact, you are the eyes and ears of this whole program, as the director sir was just mentioning. In fact, you will be soon part of the whole movement for to be there. And your support is very vital on this. And a lot of good points have come out of this. We also take note of that. And thank you all very much. Thank you.
And since Kala off dais, we'll still do that. A small token for Professor Kodan Raman and Professor Bhaskar too for taking time off. Thank you so much, sir. Okay, so we come to the last part. We are going to introduce our team so that you know who to take the phone and call, who to mail, who to shout at also. We'll start off with the coding team. I guess all the NPTEL members are here. Please ask them to assemble here if they're not here. Okay, just before they assemble, the THX, I think, will get processed. You can just go and collect it there. That is all being done. Same like last time, we'll give you all checks that you all can deposit so that we finish it off today. We don't want to delay the process. That should get done. Lunch is available in the dining room. And hopefully, it's better organized that we don't have a rush like we did at snack time. Let's see. And anything else, we are open for discussion. We'll be outside. You can talk to us. Please give your feedback on video as we had requested. Fill up the feedback form. 21 people have already filled up the feedback. Niket wants to say something. Yeah. Yes, please, Niket. Sure.
Hi, everyone. I'm Niket Kaisare from Chemical Engineering Department at IIT Madras. Some of you might have known me because for last three times I've run a course on MATLAB programming. So when I started teaching the course in MATLAB, we went from a class of 90 students to 10,000 enrolled students, around 600 or so were registering for the exam. And this May, I started, you know, as one of the coordinators, helping them with the NPTEL effort. And you would have heard, especially for the new local chapters, you would have heard Bharti and Andrew many times talk about the scale of, of the entire operation. And you really don't get what that scale actually means. I did not get it until I actually started, working with them for NPTEL. It's a very different ball game when you're teaching a class of 90 students versus, 10,000 enrolled students versus, a lakh of students taking exam every time. So that's what I really want to, emphasize at this stage, is the amount of the scale of the operation is so large sometimes that there are going to be, things in which we would request your support in trying to, help us conduct this in a more smooth fashion. So that's really the only thing I wanted to talk about as we end this session. Okay, so thank you very much, and I look forward to working with all of you going forward. Thanks.
Okay, I think there's one SPOC who came in, but we forgot, we didn't kind of missed out in the list. Pace Institute of Technology and Sciences, Dr. Ramachaitanya is here. Can you just come up again? Sorry. Pratap, can you come up? Okay, so if the coordinators can stay on stage, please. So I'd like to introduce the coding team. Satya, Jeffrey, Prem Kumar, please come on stage. Swarna, Raja, Gopalakrishnan, Logeshwaran, Ponni, and Ambika. So these are the guys who manage the entire NPTEL.ac.in portal, your local chapter portal, NOC portal. They develop scoring tools for us. They develop a question paper authoring tool for us. A lot of analytics comes from them. So they are the guys who code and keep everything up. Certification automation happens from them. Certification printing is taken care. Next comes the course builder portal management and SWIM portal management team. It's headed by Lakshmi Priya, supported by Jagadishwaran, Raghavi, and Srinath. Kindly come on stage. Then third, we have the design team headed by Clifford and Hussain. They do the certificates. They do whatever posters you see, brochures you see, the booklet that you see, and so on. Hussain and Clifford, please come forward. Okay, then we have the hard disk copying guys. Any of you have brought hard disk for copying to us? Saravanan is the person to go to. Saravanan, please come forward. He will collect it from you, copy it, ensure that it reaches your college. So that is Saravanan for you. Amuda and Manisha, who handle the industry associate program newly formed. They are one of our newest joinees, so please come forward. Then we have Niveda and Vasudha also supporting us in our operations. Please come forward if you're there. Okay, then we have the NPTEL website content uploading and certificate print management person. It's not a team. Gokul, he's a one-man army who does a lot of things. He does this and that. So any of you has not received certificates are missing, there he is, catch him. He will know what to do. except that he seems missing now. Okay, let him come in. And then we have NPTEL, the QP team, the team that handles all the question papers. We won't give you access to them so that you can get the question papers from them. They are totally in secret, protected, away from your eyes. But here they are today. Anita, Vinodini, Maria, Purnika, Parkavi, Anupriya. Please come forward. So they are the ones who translate the QPs given by faculty into the TCS system and do all that stuff. Then we have the social media team. I don't know how many of you are following us on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn recently. I think we have pushed a lot of campaigns there. We are doing a lot of updates there and so on. So we have a team actively working on it, headed by Hemavati, supported by Anjali, Raghavi, and Revati. Please come forward. Then we have the text transcription team, which comprises Prabhakaran, Ranjita, Sumalata, Tanu, and Basumati. Divya is also with us. Currently, she's working out of Bangalore, so she's not here today. Then we have the translation effort, which is going to be headed by Merin and another Divya, Divya Junior. Then we have the studio team who does all the new videos and course videos for us. Anybody is finding any changes in the videos put out by NPTEL IIT Madras? We are telling ourselves we have improved in our presentation and the way we are doing it, and it looks better, we keep saying, but I don't know if you'll have feedback. So the guys behind that is Akshay Kumar, Karthik, Gomati, Mahesh Kumar, Mohanarangan, Ravichandran, Balaji, Vignesh, and Benjamin. Please come forward, studio team. In fact, they're covering the event for us today, and we are also webcasting this event. It's live today on Facebook and on YouTube. So they are the people responsible for it. Then we have our help and assistance, without whom most of things would not go. In fact, we had a small collection of pictures wherein if you all had come to our office by maybe mid-June, you all would have seen us like a post office with some 50,000 certificates in our office. We are packing and sending it. Brochures were going out. Booklets were going out. The guys who are primarily responsible for that, Madhu, Jabiraj, and Krishna Kumar. The people who made arrangements today, banners that are out today, the bags that you all have gotten next to you, the packing of those bags, purchase, everything these guys handle. So Madhu, Jabiraj, and Krishna Kumar, I request them to come. Then we have a small data analytics team that is we are putting together for more analytics that comprises Jay Krishnan, who is not here currently, Yayati and Yogesh, I request you all to come forward. Okay, and a surprise, I see the accounts team already here, which I'm hoping they finished all the TA because they're coming in for the photos. So that comprises Murli sir, please come forward. Renuka and Surya, they handle the entire accounts of MHRD, the recent accounts, the exam fees we collect, paper processing, the tenders we do, everything moves through these three people. I'll keep the people you interact with for the last, so that's why I've held back on the LC team. So the LC team is here, headed by Kamala Ramakrishnan, Helen, Deepthi, Catherine, and Niharika are part of the team. So anything that you'll want with queries to LC, y'all can write to them. One of our, he'll get offended if I say that, but one of our oldest, not in terms of age, but one who has been with us from the beginning, I'd like to call upon Kannan sir, Kannan Krishnamurthy sir, to join the team. He is the one who actually set up the whole infrastructure for the studios here. So most senior in terms of experience, he sets up our studios. In fact, he's a consultant today, I think almost all over India. If any institute wants to set up a studio, he's the person to go to. He keeps abreast of all the latest technologies, does everything with respect to recording and all that. So that's Kannan sir. We have our coordinators, Professor Andrew Tangaraj, Pratap Haridas, and Niket, who has joined us recently. Three coordinators, and I'm Bharti, also a part of the team, yes.